People who quit a job in the heat of the moment, what chow did you leave them to handle? Didn't get a bonus because they felt the overtime I did paid me more than the bonus they gave to everyone else. I didn't know what to say to that, so after a few hours I offered to get coffee for everyone. Then I left and never came back or contacted them again. I keep thinking that I should go back with coffee now I've been gone 10 years and just act normal. That would be the realest thing I've ever heard of a person to do. When I was a programmer at an insurance company, one of the long-time programmers had been with the company for nearly 20 years. This guy originally wrote most of the financial system himself, from scratch, and had maintained it with the help of a couple of other people. Every month he did the month-end processing and every quarter he did the quarter-end processing. Every year-end? Yep, it was him. There was a change in management a couple of times, and he kept getting treated worse and worse. He was being treated unfairly, asked to do unreasonably more work than he was already doing, getting thrown under the bus, that kind of thing. He finally had enough and one morning he came in, walked to the manager's office and quit, then walked out the door. In the aftermath it took a team of four other people, months and months to get things back together and to a point where things were serviceable. You don't frick with your IT people, learned that crap the hard way in the army. Worked for a landscape company doing new installs. Our owner was cheap with a bad habit of constantly biting off more than he could chew. One year he asked if we wanted any part of a school project in a city we didn't live in, over 2 hours away, and we said no. He said that was fine and would just bid on one school for his crew who lived in that area. Instead he bid on multiple schools and got three of them. Obviously, none of us are happy about this and he claimed that he'd put us up in hotels so we wouldn't have to commute. He never did. The work itself sucked. Way more than a crew our size could handle and the owner's brother did absolutely nothing. He was supposed to be the project manager supervisor and literally all he did was play Clash of Clans on his phone and yell about people not being fast enough. After a few days, I was done. I'd grown sick of the job anyway but this project really sealed it. Having to commute 4 plus hours a day and then physically destroy myself was taking a toll fast. I woke up Friday morning, called the owner, told him I quit and to stop taking more work than he can manage. He blew up but I just hung up the phone and went back to sleep. 2 weeks later I get a call from him. He's begging me to come back because after I quit, two other guys did too. The project is now woefully behind schedule and he's going to get fined if things don't pick up and get finished. I told him he should have thought of that before he bit off more than he could chew and expected a small crew to do it all in a short time frame. He got quiet and then asked if a 50 cent raise would get me back. Haha no. Last time I ever heard from him and I can't find his company website anymore. 50 cent raise. 18 years old. Assistant manager at a big pizza franchise. Had been working open to close for 2 weeks straight because the new GM went on vacation right after taking over the store. When she got back from her vacation she worked a half day. I opened and still closed. Then she changed the schedule and took 2 days off. This was the last straw on top of a ton of other crap piled over a year. Multiple new GMs, crappy district manager, awful store politics. I was alone during an unusually large lunch rush and was just done with everyone's crap. I had a McAline full of orders, phones ringing, oven full of pizza, orders to be picked up, and a massive batch of dough sitting on the prep table. I said frick it. I shut the oven off, walked out, and locked the store. Didn't call anyone to let them know. It would be hours before the evening driver would roll in. No prep for the day, no dough for the day except for the blob I am sure would become a massive mess after rising for hours. A double-deck oven with both belts full of pies wasted and what was probably shaping to be a $1,200 lunch out the window. I hope she was well rested after her time off. Shoppers freaking drug mitt. I had simply asked for better hours after working ridiculous late night hours for over a year. Instead they hired a new guy and gave him the exact hours I asked for and then had me train him. So when training wasn't going very well because new guy was super slow, they blamed me for it. Now I had a good standing with everyone at this store but I didn't need shoppers and I let a lot of crap slide every day. So again when I asked for a vacation that I deserved because I was never sick and punctual as all heck, I was denied it and the next day the manager had 4 weeks of vacation set. So to make it up to me, they offered me all these insane overtime shifts for the next 3 weeks. So I waited for the frozen deliveries to arrive that same day. The boss was packing up to go home, and when he said goodnight to me, I said, "But who is going to do this frozen delivery?" He laughed and said, "You are." So I replied, "Nope." And he became super cross, so I started laughing. "What are you laughing about?" he says. So I said, "Frick yourself. I quit." Now there was no one to finish the night shift. He immediately asks for the uniform, lol. Nah. I said, "Frick yourself. I quit." I had never done that before or since. Uniform went in the trash. That's the crap I'm looking for. Of like that instant karma type crap. Always work the close shift at a fast food joint. My managers love to hand out citations for any little thing. The policy was 3 strikes and you're out. I had 2 strikes left and was told to clean up the entire front end and bathroom in an hour or risk getting a 3rd strike. To put things in perspective, I had to close the register, count the money, clean up the front end, restock everything, sweep and mop the floors, and clean the entire bathroom, including the toilets, for basically $8.05. I walked into the bathroom, just to see what to expect. Looked like someone had finished projectile crapping all over the toilet and then decided to pee next to the sink. I knew I wouldn't be able to do everything in an hour and that I would get fired regardless. So, I took my uniform off and walked home shirtless. Should've thrown it onto the floor. I worked as a small engine repair tech for a larger company. I am also in the National Guard. I had gotten hurt and needed physical therapy, and 1 or 2 days a month I would have to miss because of an extended drill weekend. Well, my boss didn't like that and she decided that she would punish me by making me stay later than everyone else. She was punishing me for going to physical therapy for a workplace injury and for being a soldier. Now, you may be thinking, having to stay late to keep up on your work doesn't sound like that much of a punishment. Normally, you would be right, but trust me, she was doing a lot more to make sure it was a punishment. Well, one day after being told that I was not given approval for the 1 day of vacation I asked for 3 months in advance to go see the eclipse and generally being treated like a slave, I was like, why am I doing this to myself, and clocked out at the end of my shift. That next Monday after drill weekend, I showed up, packed up all my tools and took off. My boss started freaking out when she saw what I was doing. I left and found out that me leaving cost her over $100,000 because she had to ship my workload to another state to get another shop to work on them. That meant she needed to pay to ship them, and then pay to ship them back, and since her shop didn't do any of the actual work, she never saw any money for any of the repairs. It was over 80 riding mowers. Holy heck. I hope she learned her lesson. I get frustrated with people like this. People who don't treat other people like people. Super happy to hear that she was out 100k. I was a hostess for Dennis in Arkansas. The waitresses continuously degraded me, and on top of that, my manager is a functioning alcoholic. The cash registers broke trillions of times and I kept getting yelled for crap I literally had no control over. One day the registers went down the same day the AC went down. I had plenty of people coming up yelling at me because I wasn't getting tickets out nor was I getting anyone cashed out. People were piling up. I was getting yelled at because I wasn't sitting people fast enough because I was dealing with those who had exact change so I could get them out and put it in the register when it came back online. Suddenly, I heard one of the waitresses comment on how red my face is. "I'm dehydrated," I replied, as I'm not allowed to have drinks up front. I had a water bottle hidden, but I could only take a few stealthy sips an hour. A waitress found it during the ocean of people raising heck with me, and took it from me. I lost my crap and quit later that day. I left midway through the ocean of people to attend to my mom during her doctor's appointment. Denny's is funny online, but every Dennis I've encountered is a real shitshow. So glad I don't work with people anymore. I spent some time working at a gas station where my supervisor would take about 20 smoke breaks a day while demanding that the rest of us work harder. After several days of this, and my boss not doing anything about it, I quit in the middle of a pizza order rush. Yes, it is cases. For some reason, I was reluctant to give away the real name at the time of writing this. I worked in shipping and receiving for a health food store. Over the past 5 days everyone else had quit, including supervisors and department heads. I was working a frozen shipment, My regular job. Dairy came in. Cheese came in. A bit over $130k. Huge fancy cheese in whole wheels. A large generally organic dairy shipment. I refused to sign any dang thing. GM demanded I sign and put it away. Signing was already out of my pay grade. Those numbers made it way the heck out of my pay grade. He then demanded I put it all away. It would have taken the rest of my shift for my own work. I just quit. Frick it. Heard he signed it in and it all went to waste. He was fired. Sweet moldy justice. Got offered a kitchen job by a friend of mine who was going to be head chef at a new place that was opening. Started there and it was a pretty cool job, until about a month later when the owner yelled at my head chef friend in front of a dining room full of guests. So my friend puts in his notice right on the spot and finished his 2 weeks where he was replaced by a new chef. New chef was nothing short of a Nazi, always berating employees, nothing was ever good enough, and he especially had a hard on for me and was constantly giving me crap over anything he could think of. I found out that my chef friend got a spot at a big theme restaurant, guitars on the wall hint, hint, that opened recently, so I requested half a day off for a doctor's appointment, went there and got hired on the spot. Then called the restaurant and told the hostess to tell dickhead chef that I wasn't coming in for the rest of the shift, and every shift after that since I was quitting. But here's where it gets good. I went back over a week later to get my last paycheck, and dickhead chef basically cornered me, told me what I did was unprofessional, and since he heard about where I was now he was going to call my supervisor and tell him how unprofessional I am. Then he asked me the name of my supervisor. To which this brought a crap-eating grin to my face as I enthusiastically told him the name of my supervisor, who just so happened to be my chef friend who just quit and who this Nazi butthole just replaced. I swear it was like watching a big balloon that rapidly deflated. He just had a dumbfounded look on his face as he muttered out, "Oh, well, tell him I said hi." The best part was that his assistant chef was nearby, who really wasn't fond of him either, and he was trying to keep from busting out laughing. Walked out of there feeling like a boss. Bonus. About a month after I left, butthole chef made the mistake of pee off a dishwasher because he forgot to clock for his shift. And even though butthole chef knew dang well he was there the whole time, he refused to make the adjustment and told him tough crap. You learned a lesson. Meaning he just worked his full shift for nothing. Now this dishwasher was a big black dude who was built like a Steelers linebacker. So he grabbed butthole chef in a bear hug and started slamming him against the wall as hard as he could. My ex-girlfriend was working the host stand and told me she kept hearing this dull thumping sound coming from the back of the restaurant. Then one of the kitchen workers came running up. Butthole chef screamed to him to go get help. And he was laughing so hard that he couldn't tell them what was happening right away and had to catch his breath first. The place then folded about less than a month later. Famous footwear. During the interview, manager wouldn't shut up about how she wanted the other person but would hire me just to give me a chance. Worked there for 5 shifts. On day 2 she went and asked my previous managers about my private life. The one that really peeved me was she specifically asked my last employer who was employing my roommate while my roommate was on shift if I was sleeping with my roommate. On day 3 she got mad at me for doing something wrong after refusing to train me. I asked numerous times about pricing shoes. She would just do one silently without showing me where to look on the scanner or what exactly she was scanning or anything and then hand it back as if she had retrained me. On day 4 she berated me saying if I quit it would royally frick her vacation up, which was the only reason she hired me over the other person. But now she wouldn't have time to train a new person to cover her vacation which was still 2 months out. My roommate put in notice at her job on this day. On day 5 manager hears that roommate got a better job. She confronts me saying I better not quit and then asks if I planned on putting in 2 weeks. I tell her I'd been considering because she refused to train me and she was asking inappropriate questions to my previous employers. She went off on me, yelling at me on the sales floor telling me not to ever come back. She then put that she had terminated me in my paperwork due to insubordination and theft as well as sending my one and only paycheck to the wrong address 5 times before I finally got HR to just cancel the old checks and mail it directly to me. My last day was on a Saturday. All except one of her staff quit by the following Tuesday. 3 days later, I accidentally brought one of the box knives home. I called asking if she wanted it back and she threatened to call the cops if I ever showed up again. During the trying to get my check, I mentioned the questioning of my previous employers. They said they would deal with it. I moved out of town and never went back anyways, so not sure if she still works there. I did get my check. However, she lied about how much I would be making, so I was about $30 a short because I was making 13 hourly instead of 14.50. Was so fed up with everything I said frick that and just called it the amount I would willingly pay to have her out of my life forever. She was quite the C. I was working at a small bar hotel in some remote place. The manager was an absolute jackass. Just rude to staff and the customers and unpleasant to be around. There was only a small handful of staff there expected to work all day every day, myself included. We were casuals. I worked 9 long days in a row, finishing really late and getting up really early in the morning to come back and clean the hotel. With not many hours in between, pretty sure illegal in Oss. It also wasn't that close to my house, about a 40 minutes drive each way. I had a day off after my long stint doing lots of shifts, which I was excited about, and planned a nice day out with my BF, but the manager rings me the day before to ask me to cover someone's shift who wanted it off. I said no, I had plans. He lost his crap and told me when I started I agreed to work weekends and I need to be available. Well, yeah, I worked every weekend since I started and I would have been available, but I wasn't rostered on originally. Decided I had enough of being treated like crap and the money wasn't worth it to dread coming to work. I don't like confrontation and felt bad my friend got me the job, so I wrote a letter quitting and planned to leave it on manager's desk and GTFO there. Plan half failed cause I got asked to stay back at work and panicked cause manager was out, so it was perfect to leave the letter on his desk, but if I stayed back he'd be back and I wouldn't have the chance. Stayed back for a bit then decided stuff it, I'm leaving, so said I forgot I had an appointment. Dropped the letter and ran. I was casual so didn't have to give notice. Manager has a big party booked in for the next day and I was his only staff who could work it, not anymore. He rang me non-stop for 2 days and I ignored it. Best decision ever. That was pretty mild up until he had people coming in the next day, so when that crap hit the fan he rung my phone for 2 days. Nice. I worked as a porter at a pretty busy bakery once. The owner must have been at least 500 pounds and being that this was a family business, his wife ran the front of the shop. It wasn't long before she started making passes at me and grabbing me in extremely inappropriate ways. I was 18 at the time and she must have been in her 50s. Either way, this was very unwelcome attention and eventually I got fed up and quit. I specifically chose a holiday, Valentine's Day, because I knew that they would be swamped. I was tasked with cleaning everything up at the end of the day and prepping everything for the next day. Needless to say, I left everything the way it was. Did not prep a single thing and dumped a bunch of flour on the floor and spelled out I quit in the flour. I had a lot of angry voicemails the next day, but I never regretted doing what I did. That's messed up that she could get away with it. Worked at a KFC. A kid had shat into his hands and flung it at the ceiling where it promptly fell down and splattered on the floor. From what I had gathered, sometimes you have to do crappy, no pun intended, things in your job. I wish we had the staff to be able to do crappy things. We're supposed to have 4 people out front, 3 serving packing, 1 on the floor. They only had me because they wouldn't get anyone else in. I had to straight up tell people, yes mom, I know there's crap on the floor in the toilet but I can't clean it right now because there's 20 people in the queue and I have to pack orders. People in the middle of the queue started shouting open another till like I can just magic people from thin air. A woman waiting for her order is giving me the evilest freaking glare that I'm taking an order rather than packing hers and I just freaking gave up. I had 2 hours left in my shift. It was only going to get busier, so I just left the front. Grabbed my crap from the locker room and walked out without saying a word. All I wanted was to get home, log onto WoW, crack open a beer and wind down in what ended up being a near orgasmic level of peace. So yeah, there was maybe 20 people waiting in line, including people who had paid for food and were waiting. Crap on the ceiling and floor in the men's toilets and nobody to serve customers. Quite the shitshow. I regret leaving people there who had paid for food, but there's only so much you can handle, especially when it feels like you've got 20 odd people mad at you and no one to back you up. All the buttholes who can only feel better about themselves by berating overwhelmed employees got what they deserved though. I quit a few hours after my shift was over, but the next day was one of our most physically intense work days. For 6 months my supervisors kept promising a raise promotion that never came. No matter how many more responsibilities I got or how well I worked, all I got were empty promises. It also didn't help that my mental physical health was starting to suffer. I sucked it up for a long time hoping that things would eventually get better, but they didn't. When I had enough, I sent in a text message to the group chat that all of the workers were a part of and said something like, "Don't expect me at work tomorrow or in the future. I quit." Once I sent in that message, a few co-workers tried reaching out to me and one of my supervisors tried to get in touch. I assume they were trying to get me to change my mind, but I was set on what I did. So I never spoke to any of my former supervisors, and it was a bit of a while before I fully opened up to my former co-workers. Besides having to deal with a physically intense shift the next day, I left them with a lot to handle. Even though I held the lowest position at that job, my supervisors knew that they could rely on me, so I had the work of 2-3 people that was more suitable for an assistant manager. Since I was on good terms with one of my former co-workers, every now and then she let me know how things were. They ended up hiring 2 new guys to try and fill the hole I left, but as far as I know, they were never able to match what I was able to do. Prior to them being hired, my supervisors tried to spread out all of the work that I left behind. That resulted in the employees that worked there being overworked and it all turned into a crap show. 3 months after I left, my former supervisors were still trying to get me to come back, but I didn't want to. Eventually, I found out that my head supervisor was lying about the promotion raise that I was promised. It was never on its way. It turned out he did the same to other workers at this job and he turned most of the employees against him. When everyone found out what a piece of crap he was and how big of a problem he was, he decided to transfer out rather than be fired. It took a few months, but after I quit, a few other workers either left on good terms, or had their contracts come to an end and chose not to come back. I like to believe that me quitting was the final straw that eventually led to all of the change that happened at this job. I had something similar happen to me. Promised a raise for months and months. I finally had enough and found a new job. Old job kept calling me at new job to come back. Nope. I worked at a sub shop for 2 years. The last 2 weeks we were so short that I was working a 70-hour work week and I wasn't even being worked the hardest. I was loyal to the company but the management wasn't fantastic and I was severely underpaid. I had a friend who knew about my work situation and without telling me referred me to his much better job. The job called one day while I was working a double at my sub shop. After I got off work I went by the place and was hired. I immediately called the owner of my store and quit. They were so short-handed that there wasn't enough people for a shift. They had 5 total employees. But now I have way better way, insurance, and great management. I'm happy with jumping off the boat. Sometimes owners of restaurants or mar and pa restaurants are so cheap, they don't want to spend more money hiring staff. It sucks. Liquorland. After being lied to, screwed out of a healthy redundancy package that I was entitled to and had a bevy of false accusations placed against me so they could fire me, none of them stuck because they were made up. I quit in my own special way. I first waited until my store manager, area manager and state manager all were on annual leave and I'd be running the shop. I then got a doctor's note giving me 3 weeks off work for a strained back muscle. That afternoon, on Friday, the busiest trading day of the week, half an hour after taking over I wrote my resignation emails. One went to the CEO, upper management and board members detailing how I'd been screwed over by my managers for the previous 18 months. Threatening legal action and going to the press if my leave payouts were withheld. The second was to my area manager's email, who was uncontactable on leave, stating my 2 weeks notice to resign and attaching a copy of my doctor's certificate that said I was unable to work. Then, I shut and locked the doors, threw the keys in the safe and went home. I turned my phone off, drank 2 bottles of wine and played the frick out of some Final Fantasy. On the following Monday, I checked my bank account to find all my annual leave paid out and my 2 weeks of notice paid out as sick leave. Still, frick you Liquorland. I refused to buy at any Westfarmers owned store thanks to the way I was treated. This was well thought out and gangster-aff. Kudos. Employers of Reddit. What's the most overqualified applicant to a position you've ever received? I worked HR at an amusement park. A guy came in who wanted to drive the little train that goes around the park. He'd been an arson and murder investigator for 30 years in a major US city and now just wanted to relax and drive a train. After much begging from us, he eventually agreed to become the new security manager, but only if we promised to let him drive the train on his days off. When I was a manager at GameStop back in 2009-2010, I had a guy apply for a store associate position. He had a master's in marketing. In his interview, I asked him why he was applying for a job he was so overqualified for, and he said the marketing firm he worked at before closed down suddenly and he needed something to keep the lights on while he searched for a better job. He got the position and was actually still there when I left GameStop. I recommended him to our regional manager as my replacement. Don't know if he got it or not though. So I found the guy on Facebook. After I left, he worked at GameStop for about another 7 months before he finally found work in the marketing world again. He's been with that firm ever since and he's doing great. He said he didn't get the manager position when I left though. It was really nice to catch up with him. Bold move to just straight up admit that he was planning to quit as soon as something better came along. I hired a man with a bachelor's in psychology, a master's in sociology, and a master's in anthropology with 20 years of teaching college experience, as a janitor. I don't know why he doesn't teach anymore, but he was having a really hard time finding a entry-level job and he really needs the insurance as he has a life-threatening illness that is being controlled with medication. Absolutely great employee and very interesting to converse with. It feels weird to be his supervisor though, as I am a high school dropout. At my middle school we had a janitor who had a degree in philosophy. He was a very interesting person and one of the few people I remember fondly from middle school. Eons ago I was an office manager for a kitty litter plant. I did some hiring as part of that gig. A guy came to apply to work on the production line. He had a 3-page resume with a master's degree and numerous publications, extensive community involvement, etc. I flat out asked him why he wants to be slinging 30 lbs boxes of kitty litter on the assembly line all day. He told me it was because a friend of his got into amazing shape very quickly and he found out it was thanks to working at our plant. We were short, so I figured why stereotype and told him he could start the next day. He lasted a grand total of 3 days on the production line. That's hilarious. A scientist, a physicist I believe, with over 20 years of research at the University of Cambridge in his work history, applied for a very basic administrative job. He was denied for having a lack of relevant work experience. He applied to replace me BTW. I was leaving that job. I was 19 or so and it was my job while I was at uni. My co-workers interviewed a super overqualified guy for a crappy retail position at the bank I work at. He was an Eagle Scout, went to a prestigious college, top of his class, won a bunch of scholarships, and basically sold his entire childhood to volunteer work. His resume was impressive, but apparently he was just fed up with corporate politics at the very well-known company he had just quit. He was instead offered a job in one of the upper departments where I work. I was hiring someone to do some basic data entry work. I was paying like $10 HR or something and was expecting to hire a student or something. Had a guy submit everything and he was mid-30s with over a decade of engineering experience on top of college. I couldn't fathom why he was applying for the job. He ended up storming off from the interview. So I suppose he was bitter about something. I worked with a guy who was a former business executive. Very intelligent guy, so had some really interesting conversations. We both made $8 HR in a call center. Me, I was trying to make extra cash in between IT jobs. He was just retired and bored sitting at home alone day living off his considerable assets. Still, one of the hardest working guys in the company. If I was just working for something to do, I think a call center would be about my last choice. I was interviewing candidates for customer service positions in a call center. This woman was a Navy medic, trained in combat situations, had a couple of degrees. She was basically the last person I expected to see sitting across from me. I accepted her for the position, but she never accepted the job offer. I don't blame her. I recently worked with a retired army medic. He was a great guy who worked hard and didn't put up with bulls. He also didn't last long, because he got a better job at a hospital. A friend of mine once put an ad on Craigslist, $20 for a couple hours to help her load a moving truck. One guy sent his full resume. A few weeks ago I had to hire a teenager to put away books after school at the public library. One 14-year-old girl sent in a full resume and cover letter along with 3-page long letters of recommendation. I interviewed her, but every question she answered she found a way to bring up one of the many awards she'd won in middle school. It was a bit off-putting. She didn't get the job. I hired a guy with several former CTO and VP of technology titles for an entry-level tech support position. The recession was not kind to him. He was the best hire I've made and killed it in that position, and others he moved up to in that company, for the next several years. Technology workers in the US who are not in their 20s have a lot harder time than most people think. H1B abuse and outsourcing have made the jobs not nearly as plentiful as people think. I had someone apply for a risk analyst position who I believe had 3 masters and 1 PhD between math, chemistry, and physics. I knew something was going to be up, but wanted to bring them in and find out what. Despite them having a meticulous resume, they couldn't speak a word of English. Very awkward time. I didn't hire him, but there's a man working at my old high school with a master's in aerospace engineering and a couple other degrees. He worked for NASA and was one of the men who helped design the craft that put men on the moon. He's the guy who checks to see if you have been signed out before you leave campus. He's got an amazing sense of humor and he has this air about him that just makes him fun to talk to. I spoke to him about his history a couple times. It's just weird to think that the guy keeping kids from sneaking off campus is a little rocket scientist. My PhD dad lost his job when I was in middle school. He applied for a job at Wendy's and was told he was overqualified. It was a tough time for him and our family, but things eventually turned around for us. I'm proud of him for being willing to do whatever it took to take care of us. You'll shouldn't put your advanced degree down if you're serious about the job. I applied for fast food, left off my BS and MS, lied and told them I had no degree. I got the job. I had 18 years experience working in a scratch bakery as a baker and full-time cake decorator. Also years of high-end restaurant experience as a side job. Quit the side job and few years later wanted a part-time job to save money to move to Hawaii. Taco Bell sent me an email saying I wasn't qualified among many other places. Pizza Hut is the only place that I could get to hire me as a driver. It was for the best. I loved working with those guys. Now I live in Hawaii. Not an employer, but when I was a freshman in college, I worked in the dining hall with a line cook who had been a corporate financial manager at a large local corporation. His company had gone under and laid off almost everyone, and he was having a hard time finding a position. He was friends with the head of dining services and ended up working as a line cook. I'm pretty sure he got promoted very quickly to management, causing some bitter feelings among the other cooks. My understanding was that the company knew they'd have a management position open several months after he applied, so they asked him to work as a cook until the position opened. As a student worker, he was the nicest man I worked with, and an incredibly hard worker. I was glad when I came back the next academic year and found him as a manager, and I hope he's doing well now. I own a catering business restaurant bar. I had a lady applying for a waitress job last year. She worked for IRS, government. She was a top accountant, but made some small money laundering at her last workplace, so nobody wanted to hire her. I hired her anyway. Top employee for less money. Everybody deserves a second chance. I employed her as a financial consultant and stock manager, not as a waitress. She doesn't have access to any official documents or bills. His job is to discuss with us and give the board financial advice because she has a great experience in the field and I want to use that. Also, every day she makes the statistics and future food stock predictions for the upcoming week, estimated usage of food and drinks, stuff like that. I was manager of a small cafe and people used to drop in resumes all the time. One day a woman who was in her early 60s came in with a resume. Usually I would thank people and put it aside until after service, but on that day I happened to take a quick glance. Her last position said she had been a consultant specialist in emergency medicine. I then saw Doctors Without Borders and a further 30-ish years of a medical career. I sat down with her and asked her why she wanted the job. She said she'd recently retired and was bored out of her skull. She was looking for a job that had the same energy requirements but without the responsibility or shift length. She then said she'd work for free, but I said if I gave her a job I'd have to pay her. She asked for $5 an hour, to which I said I'd have to pay her minimum wage. I put her on a trial and she smashed it, so I offered her 3 days a week. She was easily the most organized and stress-free staff member I've ever employed. She worked for us for a bit under a year before deciding to go back into aid work. She also donated all her earnings from that job. Still one of my favorite people in the world. I was a supervisor at a restaurant and the hostess had her master's in hospitality tourism management. She never worked before because she was always in school and had to start off somewhere. I was a host with a master's for 6 months last year. I had several years of work experience, but finding a full-time job was a B. I still don't have a job related to my degrees, but I had an interview last week. I should hear something before the end of the week. I used to hang out at a small garage that worked on mostly dirt bikes, four-wheelers, and sleds. A guy came in one day in a business suit asking about a job. He seemed friendly, talked for a bit. His only request was to have a separate work area, and to kinda be left alone. The next day the owner of the shop came out of his office with the guy's resume in hand and asked if it was a joke. Everyone told him it wasn't, to their knowledge. Anyway, the guy went to MIT, had a ton of helicopter mechanic experience and was last working for some aeronautics company. The owner of the shop called him and had him come in to talk. The guy's little brother had some terminal disease and wanted to be around more. He worked there for a couple years till his brother died and he left. I left town right as the guy was hired, but my friends at the shop said he was freaking magic with engines, but never really warmed up to anybody. A customer had brought his sled into the shop constantly for blown engines. New sled, third engine, and nobody knew what was causing it. The customer was peeved because he was only getting one or two rides per season and the rest of the time it was in the shop. The overqualified guy comes out of his corner and looks down in the fuel tank and tells them to replace the fuel pickup hose. The fuel pickup line was cracked and sucked air when the fuel got under half tank, caused the engine to not get oil to lubricate. Two stroke. Holy crap. Engine Rain Man sounds like someone I'd want on my team. Years ago while in college I had an engineer apply at Wendy's. Floored me. Then she explained that her and husband had just been transferred and she needed something until she got hired elsewhere, which made sense. I don't really understand people getting jobs like that to tide them over. You have to wait a couple of weeks for a check. Why not go be a server or delivery driver and get money that night? The janitor at my high school was a surgeon in Vietnam. He moved to America to get a better life for his son, but he couldn't speak English very well and took the job because it let his kid go to a private school basically for free. As soon as his kid graduated, he quit. Steady hands. The best. A CPA with about a dozen different accounting jobs applying for a minimum wage pick and pack job. I didn't want to hire him, but a co-worker went over my head and hired him. Turned out he was a drunk. Only lasted a few shifts before I fired him. Some guy who was a minister in the Egyptian government. No idea who. Unfortunately, it was a few years ago and I'd only been there a few months. Applied for a job at the company I work for, just mapping. They had to reject him for lack of relevant experience, but the hiring manager wrote him a letter of commiseration in rejecting him. Feeling bad she had to reject a minister. As to why he was applying, not a clue. Office gossip suspects he was trying to secure a job overseas to get out, maybe. My ex was a high up government official in the country of Turkey. He could not find a decent job in America for the life of him despite all his education, top security clearance, languages and credentials. The lack of money and job title drove him literally nuts. After 7 years of looking he went back to Turkey. I didn't hire him, but my postman was a university professor for several decades before deciding he just wanted to be a postman. Was at a job interview at an arcade once, when another applicant walks in with a suit and briefcase, so I guess he was overqualified. When I went through basic training, there was a recruit who was in his mid-30s, Chinese fellow from a rural area. After talking to him, I learned that he had a master's in physics dealing with lasers or something like that. He enlisted to get his citizenship and give back to the country that welcomed him. Nice guy. Service guarantees citizenship. Former VP of a large bank in Canada applied at my gas station because, and I quote, "That B wants me to support her and her frick boy. I have to give her half," but they didn't say half of what. I saw him a year later happily employed as a garbage man. He said his ex was furious and had to get a job. Dang. This is too good, ha ha ha. My friend has a master's and almost didn't get a hostess job for being overqualified. They figured she'd get a job in her field and leave. Almost a year later, she's still there. Either her field isn't hiring or she can't break into it for whatever reason. I wasn't the employer, but an employee, and I had a co-worker that you could say was overqualified. The manager and owner running this restaurant really had no idea what they were doing, as the owner had purchased the restaurant as a hobby and the manager was promoted prematurely due to a string of managers walking out due to the owner's inexperience. At one point we had 4 total employees in a restaurant that required 9 or 10 total to run smoothly, so the manager and owner were quite desperate to hire people. During that period, they literally had people coming in off the streets to work for one night so they could buy some extra time to hire a permanent employee. They had posted some ad on a job site that said $15 hour serving position was available, which was very easily misinterpreted at $15 plus tips. We had a guy come in for an interview in his 30s. A very professional looking dude applying for an entry level serving position, looking for some extra income as he was trying to start his family. Our boss for some reason never talked about wages in the interview, so it went completely under the radar for this guy. This new guy came to his first day of work ready to make bank, and within 5 minutes we got talking and he said something like, "If it's a busy night and I make a lot of tips, I will be making more per hour here than I do at my aerospace engineering job." And then I just told him he must be mistaken, because we were making $4.95 hour and the restaurant was never busy enough to break $10 hour. The guy took off his name tag and walked out. We never saw him again. Not an employer, but my older sister has a PhD in some medical field. I've read her book, which is on TB. Quite amazing. Anyhow, she has seriously struggled to get a job and had to start taking her PhD off of her CV, as everyone kept saying she was overqualified. But she's a teaching assistant, and when her colleagues somehow found out she has a PhD, their jaws dropped. I myself dropped out of uni. I am kind of in this position right now. I have 16 years experience as a software design lead in COBOL. There is almost zero demand for that near me, and I'm losing my job in a week. I have a few years of Java dev work, so I'm trying to make that transition, but it is difficult. I used to work in a retail store as a student worker. Most of the employees were people who left school at 18 or even 16. Can't say anything bad about most of them, but TBH, they weren't the smartest bunch. Anyways, there was one guy with a PhD in chemistry. Although he enjoyed working there, it was the biggest waste of knowledge I've ever seen. Not a manager, but I got to rifle through the resumes at my old job as a receptionist for my replacement. It was a small family-owned business. Anyway, I remember one applicant listed all the firearms he was trained at, including machine guns. This is actually strange because guns are illegal in Australia. I assume he was an ex-army guy and needed to submit his resume to X number of places in order to keep getting benefits. Why else would anyone think that a list of guns one is proficient in and nothing else is relevant to a reception position? If he was applying for a receptionist position at Centrelink, it might have been relevant. An old professor of mine. A little less than a year after I graduated university, I went back there recruiting for a summer internship at the company I worked for. My professor came by looking for a summer internship, dropped off his resume and CV full of publications and articles and grant work, a doctorate and 2 masters, for a job where basically the only requirement was understand the concepts he taught in his intro level course. To be fair, he was upfront about the reason he wanted the job, and it was pretty reasonable. He just wanted to keep up with what's going on in the industry. I have had a guy tell me when applying for a butcher's job, and I quote, "I didn't think you understood what the job was, and that you may not want it because you came in here dressed up for the job interview. Facepalm." While I wouldn't turn someone down for being dressed decent for a job interview, I liked it when someone showed up for an interview at one of the fab shops I worked at, not dressed badly, but dressed as if he or she was ready to go to work right then. Not an employer, but I went to a not well-known university in New Jersey and my law professor was an absolute genius. He graduated from NYU and wrote 3 books. He essentially knew the answer to any question anybody ever had. Some students didn't like him because he actually challenged his students and the class wasn't a cakewalk. I loved the class though and was wondering why this guy is teaching at some crappy school in NJ nobody cares about. Worked at Hot Topic as a store manager and had a guy come in and apply for a part-time associate position. He was the bassist of a very well-known emo band. I was like, why do you want to work here? He told me that he could already see the end was coming, less attendance at the shows, the burnout of touring more and more just to keep the same amount of ticket sales, album sales to make the record label happy, etc. He was already predicting the death of the band and wanted to get ahead of it, so he wanted to work for us through the holiday season, get something on his resume, and apply to college. He ended up working at a store closer to his parents' house and went to college. I have no idea where he went after that, but I do know about 2 years later we stopped carrying their shirts and merch. He was right, the band didn't make it, and no, I won't name the band. People deserve to live private lives even if they were famous for a few years. Ah, John Paul Jones. Yep. What work moment made your attitude go from proud employee to I'm just here for the paycheck? One day on my way to work I got into a car accident. Car totaled. Grandpa we wasn't sure was going to make it, me possible concussion. I called into my job to explain why I can't come in. Their response was unless bones are broken no excuses, get to work. From that day forward my job was just a check to me. I used to come in early and stay late with no thank you out and them trying to short my paycheck. From then on no more. Boss at department store wanted me to pressure people into buying crap they didn't need. Old fella came through, needed help with his disconnecting internet. I know my networks, identified from his information that the fault was the Ethernet cable between his gateway and wireless AP. Sold him a cheap cable. Boss tells me I should have tried to sell him a new router too. Guy was a freaking pensioner, you slimy see. I quit a few days later. Frick that crap. I refuse to lie to sell crap. My store had been struggling to meet its targets for a while. So we buckled down and did our best and we exceeded our weekly target. No other store in our district managed this. On our weekly conference call, my district manager asked us why we didn't do any better and implied we were lazy. I phoned her after the conference call and essentially told her to never accuse me or my staff of being lazy ever again or we would make sure that this store never meets its targets ever again. From that point on, I stopped caring about my job. I stopped trying to meet targets, to implement mandatory changes on time, respond to emails in an acceptable time frame, discipline my employees. I took longer lunch breaks than was acceptable and encouraged my staff to do the same. At some point my district manager asked me why we didn't do a certain thing that was apparently critically important and I replied, "It's clear that nothing we do will ever be good enough for you. So we stopped trying to please you. We're focused on pleasing our customers and not hating every day that we come into work." A few months later I resigned, taking a position with another company that was, strangely, made up of a lot of employees from the company I had just left. We were all able to commiserate. The store I left had a complete staff turnover shortly after. Everyone was let go and replaced. Then they did a complete turnover a year after that and, just the other day, I was in the shopping mall and I saw the store was closed permanently. When my first job at a grocery store made me literally pick up human feces because someone crap on the floor of the bathroom. Went from psych to have a job to I hate everything about this real quick. I caught our manager stealing from the company 3 different times. The owner of the business is his best friend from high school. After the 3rd time when the owner kept him on for humanitarian reasons, I thought frick it, I turn up and do my job, that's all. Back in the early 90s I was a radio announcer at a small AM station in suburban Minneapolis. I had been working weekends there for $5 an hour. Yes, you read that right. And when they made me full-time they just multiplied $5 times 40 hours per week. After I had been working there for a while, I found out the weekend announcers had gotten a raise to $5.25, and I was still making $5. I made a stink and they gave me a raise. A few months later, I found out that the new receptionist they hired was also being paid more than me. I raised a stink again and got another raise. In 3 years there, those were the only raises I got. I knew the only way to improve my situation was to leave. I continued to show up, but I was no longer working for them. I was working to improve my skills and make a color demo tape so I could leave. When I quit a few months later, the manager tried to throw it in my face as if he had gone to the mat for me and gotten me those raises. This sorta happened to me. I started off at 11 per hour, and I later found out their minimum was actually 12 per hour. I respectfully went to the general manager, and 1 month later I'm still at the same rate. I've been there for 4 months and I just work there now to get a free membership for the most expensive gym in my town. I work part-time at a restaurant to pay for college. I had told my boss that I had worked there a year and thought it was time to start thinking about advancement. These talks have been hinted at for a few months now. Just the other day he hired someone that I have to train so they can have the job I've been hunting for. His reasoning was that these people are trying to make a life out of this job, but for me he thinks I'm going to just move on after I graduate. That was eye-opening for me. So instead of putting in extra hours and even popping in between classes to see if they need help, now it's more like I'm only going to show up on the days I'm scheduled, and outside of those hours that place doesn't exist. Nothing like when your boss makes their own self-fulfilling prophecies. Well, I wasn't really thinking about leaving this place after graduation, but now. Respond to work emails regardless of the time of day or day of the week. Work extra hours at least 3/5 days a week to meet my boss's ridiculous demands and do a frick ton of work that isn't in my job description. Boss told me at a quarterly review that I wasn't committed enough to the business. It was genuinely like a switch. One of my co-workers, Peggy, unexpectedly died, which was sad and awful. On top of that, it took 5 months to fill the position, and in the interim, my boss asked me to take on all of Peggy's workload by myself, since I am the only person in the department with that skill set. So I worked my butt off. Then I applied for the open position, a step above mine, and was turned down. Then I had to train the new hire on how to do the job. I come in on time or early every day, stay till the end of my shift or later if need be, pick up the pace when it's busy. Then I started to notice that everyone else shows up 10 plus minutes late consistently and no one questions it. They usually leave 5/10 minutes early and keep at one slow pace all day long. There's also nowhere to move up in the company. Everyone gets the same pay raise every year, and no good deed gets acknowledged. Everyone gets the same pay raise every year. Lucky. When I was up for a shift leader, retail manager, position, I had the best performance score in the store. Previous management experience, had the support of the assistant manager, and I even had one of the other applicants drop out when they heard I was up for the spot. The store manager hired from outside the company to fill the spot. Sounds like you were making someone insecure. I used to work as a recruiter for a for-profit school. There were thousands of us with the title of assistant director of admissions. We were basically glorified telemarketers. I took the job because the pay was decent and I truly believe that everyone should get an education who wants one. I myself was a non-traditional student, so I know about going back to school later for a degree. My first clue should have been the interview. The director asked why I wanted to work there, and when I said stuff like helping others get an education, he looked at me and said, "I work here so I can drive that Benz in the parking lot." Over the period of several months, I had a lot more disillusioning moments. Things like my director outright telling us that we weren't looking to recruit the cream of the crop students, reading the fine print in our placement rates that we pushed, which said that if you got a job after graduating then we counted you, regardless of whether it was in your field. So, congrats to all those game design grads working at McDonald's. Finding out that we really only cared if you made it past the 2 week, 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 the 2 week. What finally did it for me was the day my boss pressured me into getting this guy to sign up for our graphic design degree. This was a man, wife or wife and kids who just wanted to provide better for them. Despite this guy being so computer illiterate that he needed his son to help him fill out the online application, we told him that our 5-1-2 computer fundamentals course would get him up to speed on not just using computers but also make him functionally literate in Photoshop and Illustrator. I suppose if you were a genius, this might be true, but if you were talking to me, that was unlikely to be the case. I let my boss push the sale recruitment because this guy seemed excited and I hoped he'd somehow pull it off. It was almost too easy. Sure as crap. 2 weeks later, his wife called me crying, saying he was trying so hard but just kept falling behind and that he had to drop out, after he'd of course dropped hundreds on the Adobe Creative Suite, books, tuition, etc. From that point on, I didn't recruit another student. I stopped trying, became an insubordinate butthole, started dumbass fights with management, like over wanting to know why women got to wear skirts to work but I couldn't wear a kilt, and basically goofed off all day until I finally decided to quit. To this day, I feel bad about anyone I recruited and take great delight in the backlash we see now against for-profit colleges. If there is a heck and I go there, this will be a big reason why. I taught at that school, or one very like it. Did not feel good about trying to educate students who were not college material. A few did okay, but many couldn't hack it. One of the most corrupt businesses there is. For-profit colleges. Just taking advantage of the poor, illiterate, and desperate. The moment when the manager at the bank I worked at made me apologize for upsetting a customer who screamed at me, threw rolls of quarters at my face, and called me a freaking idiot bitch cunt. I'd like to think I wouldn't have apologized. I'd like to think I would have filed assault charges and sued for emotional damages, but I'd probably have done the same. When the regional manager decided that, in addition to giving me some great tips to help improve my salesmanship, he would insult my personality behind my back to my manager. If you're not willing to accept that people with different personality types exist and are fully capable of connecting with customers, then I'm not going to bother putting in 100% effort. Put in my 2 weeks a week ago and have been guilt-tripped several times by my manager. Good riddance. Crappy managers ruin everything. Found out my friend that got hired after me was getting paid $12 per hour. And I was getting paid $11 per hour. I was just thinking it was just based on work experience. But then she said, no dude, the manager told me minimum was 12. I really enjoyed working electronics at Target. I got to play with the tech gadgets, worked with some cool folk, and overall the guest interaction was very nice. Oh, and I rarely had to worry about zoning or a shop. Our store had one dedicated person at the boat, me, and had different employees to zone reshop electronics. Our store got a renovation right before I was hired, so we had all the gaming systems hooked up with demos and almost all the gadgets were on display to play with. I was encouraged to demo the products with guests, meaning play them in Guitar Hero, demonstrate the cameras, etc. It was great and I was making $10 HR. Then they stopped respecting my school hours by refusing me time off during my exams, despite me being approved for that time 6 months in advance when I was hired. I immediately planned when my last day would be, and the job stopped being fun at that point. It was a shame, because the day before I realized I had to quit, I ordered a bright red blazer to wear to work for fun. Good thing I root for teams with red as their color. When I was a cashier at Borders, we had to keep a certain percentage of Borders rewards transactions. I was good at my job and was able to get in the high 80s by being a good salesman and convincing them to get it. There was another guy I worked with who kept his percentage up by cheating. He would just swipe a card and put it into people's bags without saying anything about it. Eventually he got caught and almost fired, but the settles on putting him on probation and having a manager watch his transactions closely. Fast forward about a month and I find out he's getting promoted to work on the floor with all the movies and music. I could not believe they promoted him after all that crap and looked me over. Someone that was a hard worker that did a really good job and often would have people compliment me to my managers. After that, I stopped caring as much. Still kept my numbers up, but not as high as I used to. Ended up getting fired from there a couple months later because the guy that was covering my shift while I was on vacation was fired. So I had too many unexcused absences. I'm glad that company tanked. You were valuable in your position, so they didn't want to promote you out of it. They weren't going to rely on that other guy to get high 80s. It really sucks, but that's the way it works sometimes. When I wrote a detailed report and outlined how we could reallocate current assets for greater efficiency and profits and was accused of being disloyal and told to be thankful that I had a job anyway, I quit the next day and landed a better job with better pay and benefits the next week. You earned the largest raise I can give you, $0.10 hour, and had one of the best reviews on staff, but since you're leaving in 5 months, we aren't going to process the raise since it won't go through for about 6 weeks. When you're making $8 an hour, a $0.10 raise isn't much, but it's something. Also found out they were about to give one of my trainees a $0.50 hour raise, which would put her rate above mine. I felt so much schadenfreude when she got fired. Nearly died from going overboard on a small boat while letting the lines go in stormy conditions. Complained to the safety rep, who said an investigation into the matter would be held. That never happened. Welp, I work as an assistant manager in retail. This week the second assistant had a kid and the store manager went to a different city for a store setup. This caused me, an 18-year-old high school student, to work 57 hours in 9 days, as well as dealing with school and college work. That work week wasn't bad and I didn't complain about that. But the last day of the marathon was a Jordan shoe release day. There were 3 people scheduled to work. One for the door, one for the register, and one for the shoes. One of my employees got hurt, which brought us down to 2 people. The crowd of nearly 70 people took a hold of this opportunity and stormed the store when a kid opened the door trying to sell his sick butt J's. This resulted in a massive fight, hundreds of dollars of stolen merchandise, and the cops being called. It was a fun week. I worked for a company that traveled around installing video cameras and other electronics into police cars or company vehicles. I used my personal vehicle and within a couple of months had put about 25,000 miles on it. We also worked up to 12-hour shifts in the cold and rain until our work was completed. We also stayed on the road at least 20 days each month. I didn't mind because the owner was cool and the pay was good. One morning after picking up my helper, I stopped at a gas station to fuel up for a trip to Kansas. The company credit card was declined and I called my boss to ask him what was going on. He gets mad at me because I hadn't figured out that the card wasn't any good sooner and BF'd me for about 10 minutes, saying that he could have gotten cash to me if I had told him sooner. After that I began job hunting and did the bare minimum to not get fired. I hadn't figured out that the card wasn't any good. I'm sure the card was fine. It just doesn't work when the boss doesn't pay the bill. Good call starting the job hunt. I work at a gym that hosts child's birthday parties, which should be enough for a "I'm just here for the paycheck" attitude on its own. The moment that made me hate that job with every fiber of my being was the day a kid threw up in the bounce house after eating 3 blue frosted cupcakes. Children continued to play in it and tracked the vomit everywhere. After the party left, early, might I add, due to blue puke damage, my manager went into the bounce house to try to clean it. Well, she threw up on top of the blue throw up. I was the only other employee there that day, so guess who got to clean all that? Me. I make minimum wage. Frick this job. That sucks, but props to the manager trying to do it herself first. I do bathroom remodels. About a year or so ago, the company decided to change its strategy of paying their installers. We make commission on remodels and hourly for service calls, but they'll switch the two whenever it saves them money. They will not pay installers on what is considered paid time when we go back to a recent remodel we've done to do a service. They stopped paying drive time for jobs hours away that require overnight stays. They will not pay us for mandatory meetings in the mornings. Bear in mind that we're required to do remodels as quickly as possible, one day for most wet areas, and any time we're not spending on the job is increasing how long we're working that day. We work an average of 60 hours per week, but they recently reduced the pay of some of the newer installers, mine included. They started making us take on the workload of previously subbed out work that should be subbed out, like electrical, but did not increase pay. The production manager, the guy that visits the customer before everything is ordered, tends to make a lot of mistakes, so very few jobs go smoothly or as planned. This usually results in an upset customer, but the management insists that the installers caused the problems. Crap sucks. I was a music promoter. Seriously, it was great. Get paid to go to San Fran every weekend. Hit the clubs and pass out flyers because everyone knows me. Freaking A. It rocked. I was pushed shows for the Chemical Brothers, Black Eyed Peas. Crap, we had one at motherfricking 3Com Park. Then one day, I asked for my paycheck. Boss was embezzling, owed me for a month. I told him I wasn't working another minute until I got paid since I knew he had the money. He fired me. We went to the Labor Commission. I won. Frick that guy. Every time I didn't think a dog was socialized enough to be in daycare and then was told to pass the dog anyway. It puts me in danger and it puts the rest of the dogs in danger. I'm glad I don't work there anymore. Even though I miss the cool discounts and being able to take my dog to work. I was a firefighter hired on at 22. I had the greenest view of the world. I just want to help people was the response when asked by the senior guys. Who always laughed at that. Fast forward about 2 years. 2 years of being covered in other people's pee, crap, blood, brains, puke, etc. I stopped keeping track of the dead bodies around 30. I still just wanted to make a difference. And then I respond to a DOA 4-month-old. It kinda fricks with you a little when it all snaps into perspective that more often than not, it's not the movie-esque scene of saving the day, it's more body bags, and drug addicts, and constant crap that even if you made a difference for even a single minute, it doesn't change anything about their life because it's either just routine, or the very end of it. I stayed on another miserable year because the money was better than what I'd be able to get initially, and I used the time to build my small business up and running. I wish they put a significantly shorter time requirement for pensions. I believe a person can only see and experience so many stressful things in a lifetime before it seriously affects their state of mind, usually subconsciously. My threshold was much lower apparently. I couldn't turn off. I'd carry them with me. I'd imagine how their families felt. How it might affect the ones I spoke with. Not a good habit to get into. It ultimately led to what I'd consider a drinking problem, which I've since addressed. For all the firefighters and police out there, remember to always put yourself first and freaking talk to someone if you're coping with something you witnessed on the job. Frick that bottling up mentality. It never ends well. When the customer started begging for a discount on an item that did not qualify and after I told them no, asked for my manager, who gave it to them because they were cool with each other. It was the first of many times someone whined or bullied their way into getting a discount because they were friendly with the manager. At another job, a big pet supply chain, it was when everyone kept making me clean out the bins where people put their dogs' leavings if they went in the store. Gloves were not provided. It smelled so freaking bad and people missed the plastic bag more than they should have. Call OSHA about the no gloves crap. I was a key holder at Gap and loved my job. They promoted me to a smaller store to learn from the best store director to prepare to be a store director. 2 days after being there, we were being pressured by our regional manager to get some more Gap cards. She went to the back, grabbed some old employee applications, and ran Gap card applications with those old employee applicants' social security numbers. I notified HR, and was told that I must have seen something wrong. I applied to work at J. Crew and left 4 weeks later for much higher pay and happiness. 2 years later I was the hiring manager at J. Crew, and lo and behold her application was on my desk. I marked her application as unfit for position and filed it away. In a single day, I saw a lift parked with the forks up and facing a high traffic area, a half full pallet of water blocking the emergency exit, and a bottle of wine smashed on the floor with a wet floor sign that no one could be asked to clean up. I made assistant meat market manager. The extra responsibility wasn't so bad but the perishable manager would always ride the meat department about stupid crap since she didn't know anything about it. I once was told not to order any turkeys for Thanksgiving since we had some coming in the next day. When we didn't get the extra shipment everyone freaked out, but we pulled through it like we always did. 2 months later she wrote me up for not ordering turkeys. Stuff like that really made me stop caring. I think my story is like most others. I really took a lot of pride in going the extra mile, really going out of my way to make my customers and co-workers successful, and doing solid engineering work based on sound principles. But then I realized that my bosses benefited from that approach far more than I ever would, and all they would ever do is just keep asking for more, more, more. My loyalty to them would never be matched in return. And it never will be for you, either. I'm older than most of you. I've been on this carousel for a long time. If there's any advice I would give to you, it's this. Stop waiting on your career to fulfill you. It never will. Your career is controlled by forces much more powerful than you, and they don't care about you, no matter how much they insist otherwise. Instead, look to find personal fulfillment in your non-working life. Adjust your priorities so that you don't kill yourself for work. It's not worth it. If you have to really put yourself out there, do it for your friends, your family, your beliefs, not for your job. This is meant especially for those of you who have begun to raise families of your own. The time you lose with your kids when they are young, with your spouse in a new marriage, because you wanted to be at work, you never get that time back. It is absolutely not worth the trade. Your alienated kids have no desire to show up at your retirement party and throw a bucket of Gatorade over your head to celebrate all the times you ignored them. Work is just a means to an end. Let it go. There is absolutely no shame in making other things priority over your career. You will never, ever regret choosing your family first. I was told that I would be a perfect fit for a position. Then they gave me a lame excuse about filling it with another person. That person later brought our network down a few times, screwed up stuff, and wasn't available when crap went down. I have no idea why he's still there. It's sad that he comes to me for help on crap sometimes. Whatever. Don't help him anymore. Children's ski instructor at a resort that everyone, non-skiers included, knows. During a discussion about events that had occurred that day when I was explaining the reason behind why I did something and the way I did it, it was the most beneficial for my students in multiple ways, my supervisor looked straight at me and said, "It's not about the kids. 5 years service before, 2 weeks after. Whistler. Why did that guy at work finally get fired? Guy in the shipping department kept calling the shop manager a clown to his face and was warned to stop. The guy finally got fired when he decided to play circus music at full volume the next time the boss man came around. This is pretty funny though. The music was a nice touch. She messaged in the group chat we had for employees saying something along the lines of how she hates the job and she hoped the building burned down. Loved that girl. Had a very similar situation at my workplace. Was insulting the store manager as well and apparently that's what tipped the scales. He was found sleeping under his desk. When awake he was caught repeatedly sneaking out the back door, no receptionist, and leaving for hours. He was taking credit for the work of others while trying to pawn his work off on the data entry girl. He worked there for 2.5 weeks. He put an ultrasound guided IV in a patient's artery instead of their vein. He wasn't signed off on performing that task yet and did it anyways. I worked with developmentally disabled adults. One employee was accused by a client, whom I've never seen angry before or since, of groping and staring at her naked body in the shower. This client didn't require any kind of supervision in the shower. The facility decided not to fire the employee, just move her to a different house. She was finally caught on camera sniffing client's dirty underwear while doing laundry. No one was sad to see her go. I worked at a first class business class lounge at an airport. Shift leader took pictures of me in the restroom and showed it to me laughing. He was given a stern talking to and a slap on the wrist by the general manager and so I left the company. Heard from one of the co-workers that he got caught masturbating in the restroom and the general manager let him off with another warning. Turns out one of the big bosses of the company was the one that caught him during a personal trip and fired both the team leader and general manager. TLDR. Team leader and GM got fired for sexual harassment by a big boss after evading any type of repercussions. Good to hear they both got fired. Seen too many stories in this thread where the people that turned a blind eye and did nothing don't seem to have had any punishment. I'm a software engineer. My company hired a software architect who specialized in a different field. About a week after joining, he declared we need to restructure the whole software. So far so good. Except, the new structure was not clear to anyone but himself. He could not explain what was wrong with the existing structure. Now, software engineering is still engineering. there's some leeway, but ultimately there are right and wrong answers. Reasonably adept engineers should be able to communicate and convince each other of ideas, barring their egos. This guy, though, just sort of made up his own language. Like he'd tell you the software needs to be made of boondoggles connected to flimbusters, and you'd ask what he meant by flimbuster and he'd just launch into a long, 10 uninterrupted minutes, explanation at the end of which you still had no idea. While this was going on, he was generally being annoying. Nothing earth-shattering, but he'd leave empty coffee cups on people's desks, would pull them in a brief discussion that would take up over an hour, badmouthed some of us to the rest of us, badmouthed some of us to upper management, generally sleazy stuff. It went on for 2 months. 2 months where we engineers genuinely couldn't figure out if the guy is a misunderstood genius or a scam artist, because nobody could figure out what he's on about, and he was extremely adamant about whatever it was, repeatedly bashing the existing architecture for being a dead end. It ended when one of us basically called him on his balls, told management we can't figure out what to do here, let's take all the time we need to make it concrete, and just spent entire days locked in a room with him and management, slowly forcing him to go into details. The end game was for Mr. Architect to write a document explaining in full detail what needs to be done. He had 2 weeks. He didn't show up to work after they passed, and the document he left behind was just the chapter headings. I think we dodged a bullet, but the story is so crazy I don't think I'll ever be free of the doubt that maybe he really had a good idea I was too dumb to comprehend. Sounds like he was trying to take over the place by redesigning things in a way only he understands, so he becomes unfireable. Got caught vaping in a clean room with hydrofluoric acid, butanol, and a salt bath with a temperature of 500 degrees Celsius near him. Guy always got to work high, as in, couldn't function high. We worked at a grocery store, so the work wasn't hard, but we tried extra days of training anyway. Guy said the job was too difficult and that he was going to quit. We tried to convince him not to, but left him alone after that. About a week later, we have a picture of him in the office on the do not serve wall. Turns out he sent a letter to management threatening their safety and had a no trespass and no contact order for the premises. This guy Sharky continually came to work late, civil construction site, and then went out, got drunk and crap the bed. He then tried to wash an electric blanket in the washing machine. This all happened in the share house that my company pays for. People like this are building your bridges and roads. My electric blanket is machine washable. I mean, the rest of it is reprehensible, but maybe the blanket part isn't as bad as it sounds. He missed a major deadline and didn't tell anyone and didn't show up to work to face the music. Then they found out he was assigning some of his work to another co-worker but turning it in and saying he did it. Then they tried to fire him but he didn't show up for 3 days. They basically drove to his house to fire him. Watching pee on company computers and came to work high all the time. Also was an hour or two late every day. Guy lasted 1 week. I honestly thought this only existed in movies. I didn't realize there are actually people out there stupid enough to do this. A customer finally made a complaint about a sexual comment he made. Backstory, this guy was super weird with women, got really depressed a lot and would talk about being alone forever often, despite being 24. When he was in a good mood though, he would apparently be hitting on customers as a cashier at a fast casual restaurant. He's done some pretty creepy things towards women from the stories he's told me. The kicker was when a customer pointed to a picture on the menu and said that looks delicious, to which he said not as delicious as you must be. She phoned in and he was fired. Sounds like someone I used to be friends with. Nice looking guy, nothing special, but still a nice looking guy. He couldn't figure out that the reason he couldn't get and keep a girlfriend was because he had such a crappy personality. I finally had to tell him that The Handmaid's Tale was not a how-to guide for dealing with women. We're no longer friends. 55-year-old slovenly pervert. Imagine the stereotypical neckbeard with a few more under his gut-covered belt. Walked up to a 17-year-old female employee, grabbed her face in both his hands and told her, "I want to teach you how to please a man." Security escorted him out of the build 20 minutes later. Do you think he came up with that on the spot, or something he'd been practicing 4 weeks in advance, like someone online told him that'd get him laid with certainty? You are not fired from the military, it's more like fricked up the rest of your life. In Idaho, he got caught smoking pot in 4-man berthing on base, and in the subsequent investigation was also on M, said the pot was to help him sleep after the M, and found out he had run up and defaulted on $10,000 of charges to his official youth-only credit card. All of this 4 months out of boot camp. Was told you can't smoke pot on the job site. Was told that whatever he does off the clock, like during lunch, they would look the other way. He told them he needed to smoke at all times to deal with his anxiety. I was the one to recommend him for the position. He called in one night an hour before his shift because he had an ingrown hair on his stomach. The week after that he missed 2 days because he said his dad fell off the roof. What clinched it was he waited until we were slammed and went to the bathroom for the entire dinner rush. We found out a few weeks after he was fired that his dad hadn't fallen off the roof and he'd used that excuse at 3 other jobs. I saw him a few months after that hitchhiking on the road out of town and was obviously on some really harsh drugs. I'm guessing M. The repeated daddy roof fallings drove him to the M, he swears. When he first got hired, he had an ankle monitor. He backed into a customer's vehicle 3 times. He missed work several times from being too hungover. He was a jackbutt a lot. He got pulled over because he drifted around a corner and it turned out he didn't legally have a license and got taken to court. He had gotten 3 DUIs and got arrested 2 times in 1 week. The second time he was fired, my employers finally decided not to bring him back. The second time he was fired. Oh, come on. I work at a high volume brew pub and we had this manager bartender who was completely nuts. She was crazy manipulative, threatened and physically assaulted multiple employees and constantly stole from the company. She was definitely medicated and when she drank she would act even more insane and go on tangents half to herself so you weren't quite sure if she was talking to you or not. One night she had a few drinks after work and choked out a hostess and popped a squat on our patio while guests were dining. Like legit pulled her pants down and started pee next to a table of people who were eating dinner. She was fired and banned from the premises the next day. I had a very similar colleague at a pub. Hasn't ever been fired to the best of my knowledge. I left. It was this crazy Turkish lady who told my friend Kieran he had the heart of the devil and he's going to heck for making a small mistake. And she lost 2 months worth of my tips while I found out she was making 5x what everyone else was. Way back in the day before internet at home was common. Printed some pee at work, but accidentally chose a printer locked inside a female co-worker's office. Hospital tech was working third shift. He was using an out-of-view work computer to view pee. He had been doing this for about a month before he got caught. He was caught because one of the sites had infected the computer. When the decidedly female chief mammography tech started the computer in front of a patient in the mammography room, the screen started filling up with pop-up pee ads. When the investigation was done, the listing of all the sites he visited during his misadventure used up nearly a ream of paper. I'm trying to use this mammogram but I just keep getting pictures of tea. We had someone that was impossible to work with, largely because he couldn't listen or comprehend what others are saying. This isn't a language issue. He just literally could not comprehend what he was being told. He was so self-involved that it was impossible to get him to stop and listen to someone else. I was led over him for a project briefly simply because the project was going sideways. My way of dealing with him was to not assign any tasks to him that actually had to be done. I would assign him bugs we had already decided not to fix, and then refuse to help him. His favorite thing to do was ask for help, then argue, refuse to listen, and try to make the conversation take as long as possible, keeping the other person from doing their job. In the end, he got put on a PIP. He argued with our boss about it, all the while not comprehending what it meant, then left his office and went to the office of the next person up, who obviously knew of the PIP, and proceeded to argue with him. The great part was that the PIP was about comprehension and listening skills and he completely failed to listen to this boss as well and was fired on the spot. He then kept saying he would go get his stuff from his desk and could not understand what they meant when he was told he could not go back to his desk and that they would ship him his personal possessions. He just kept repeating that he had to go back to his desk to get his stuff. Sounds like undiagnosed cognitive disability. I work at a large manufacturing plant. About once a week, a dude and his team leader accomplice would come to work before their shift, clock in, Hide out in the locker room for 20 minutes during shift change. Walk back out the gate and drive to a different job where the two would work for 8 hours. Then the accomplice would go in the system and put in a clock out time, making it look like they just forgot to swipe their badges on the way out. Getting paid over $20 an hour while not even at the place. Due to absolutely terrible supervision at the plant on off shifts, it surprisingly took months before they got caught red-handed, fired and a nasty lawsuit for fraud. There are plenty other stories, but that's the ballsiest on the part of the person getting fired that I can think of. Years back I worked in a gym briefly. The guy I replaced had been fired for getting caught having sex in the gym bathroom with a member during office hours. Idiot. For months after he left, I would have hot blondes coming into the office to complain that payments were coming out of their accounts. He had been selling memberships by telling hot chicks they could have free memberships. He would complete the sale, take the commission, and cancel payments each month. Except when he left, his plan fell apart because he wasn't there to cancel the girls' payments anymore. LA Fitness would have loved him, since they try to make it as hard as possible to cancel. You just can't show up and cancel a membership. You need an envelope and stamp to do it. At least this is how it was a few years back. Delivered pizzas for us for about 4 months without car insurance. Finally got caught after rear-ending someone on a delivery and paying him $200 cash to not report it. Told us he hit a wall. Might have gotten away with it if he didn't make a Facebook post about it the next day. Got drunk while working the bar, took his shirt off, and made out with a guy who was sitting at the bar. Fine dining restaurant. I saw this happen with a server working a $20,000 wedding buyout. He and that one girl who is drunk by the time the dance starts found each other and by the second song were making out on the empty dance floor. Dude ended up unemployed. Girl went home with her unhappy, really drunk but not as drunk husband. We all made extra in tips. Kept falling asleep. We work in an open pit coal mine. The primary job is driving a 320 ton dump truck. Now everyone gets tired. We work 2 12-hour days, then 2 12-hour nights. Nearly everyone who's ever worked there has fallen asleep at the shovel or on break. We generally fess up to it, take the slap on the wrist, and move on. This guy would insist he was blacking out, then claim he was fine to keep driving. He brought a doctor's note saying he was fine, but the company sent him to their doctor and they called bulls. Allegedly, last I heard, he was told to pick up his stuff. Though he's still making sickness and ailment pay, he's not allowed to work on the site. We worked in a hospital lab, and he mentioned several times how easy it would be to bring firearms to work and get rid of some annoying co-workers. It was all, haha, just kidding. But luckily the higher-ups took it seriously. Poked holes in the cup so when we filled them up they would pour right onto the customers. Had anger problems. Not his fault, but probably not the best quality for a fast food employee. Was lazy. Showed up late a lot. Would purposefully mess up orders and get people the wrong drinks. And wouldn't stay clean shaven. We had a pretty strict rule on having no facial hair. The last straw was that one day he didn't show up at all. When the director called him to ask why he didn't show up, all he said was, "Yeah, I just didn't feel like showing." My director then informed him that didn't need to show up ever again. No one was sad or surprised to see him go. Was working pizza and the GM hired a new driver, overall a decent guy, maybe a little slow at times, and doesn't seem to be picking up on simple things like how to do prep. About 2 months after he started, I'm the closing manager and I get a call at about 9 p.m. It's the new driver saying he couldn't find the address the customer had given him. The only problem being I didn't know he was working that night, so I ask him what he's talking about. He was the opening driver. He had taken a delivery at about 2:30 p.m. just before I had gotten there, and when he looked up the address in his phone it told him that the address was for a place on the north end of Dallas. The pizza place was in Austin. This dumb butt had driven 6 hours there, then spent another hour trying to find a place that didn't exist. The next day the GM asked me to cover his shifts for the rest of the week as he was fired for an inability to perform essential job functions. I am somewhat impressed. That is a dedicated type of stupid. I worked at a cheese factory in a small town. During the off-season there was not a lot of work to be done around the place except for maintenance and housekeeping stuff. Our store's guy would go missing on an almost daily basis and only appear an hour or two before knock-off. He would usually say that he had just popped out for lunch or that he was working on something at the back of our site. Management couldn't prove he was skipping out on work, though, and when we were on production, he was generally good at his job. So they largely turned a blind eye. Where he fricked up, though, was when there was a local go-kart competition. He skipped out after lunch and competed in the main race, placing second. It got published in the local paper the following week and the manager read it while having his morning coffee. He went over and congratulated him on the result while handing him a suspension notice. HR terminated him the next day. Kicking a possum. We get a 15-minute break at 10 a.m. and 3 p.m. At 10 o'clock break, this guy who hadn't worked there more than a couple of months walked out to the parking lot where he removed a cage trap containing a possum from the bed of his truck. He then opened the cage and shook the possum out onto the ground where it sat dazed and likely heat exhausted. The guy puts the trap back in his truck then realizes the possum is still there, so he kicks the crap out of it breaking its back to where it couldn't move if it wanted to. Then the sob just walks back inside, leaving the possum lying in the parking lot. Poor possum. Two classics from the same company. Employee A was a big dude. 6 feet 5 inches and not skinny. A crazy close talker. When he got upset, he got even closer. There were times he would be inches from someone's face. He was a contractor, so we let him go. When we checked his computer after he was escorted out, we found out he had been cruising dating sites and bomb-making websites. That HD went off to the FBI. We gave him the nickname the Lovelorn Unibomber. Employee B was just bad. He was brought in as a senior computer guy, but knew nothing. He would get halfway into something and just stop, then blamed everyone else. He had to work out at lunch, taking 2 hours to do so. Important meeting? Nope. Have to work out. What got him shitkinned was ski season. Our office was about 45 minutes from reasonably good skiing. About once a week, he would concoct some BS story about having to be in after lunch, at a meeting, in front of managers. I asked him how skiing that morning was. He turned bright red and said, it was okay. He was gone soon after. He ended up copying and pasting entire sections of other people's LinkedIn profiles to use as his own. The kid whose job included changing the folio, which is the line on each newspaper page with the page number and today's date. He was fired on August 33rd. Came to work drunk, like completely and utterly wasted. Was a radio DJ. It's bad enough to come to work drunk if you're not a radio DJ. It's extra bad to come to work drunk if you are a radio DJ. On your family friendly in the Canadian equivalent of the Bible Belt. Believe it or not, his career recovered. Nice dude who made a mistake. Almost didn't want to share this one because of that, but it's too good not to share. I almost feel like I know that guy. Or it's more common than I thought. Same story. Was a radio DJ in my town and part-time terrible stand-up comic. Always getting suspended or fired and bounced out to Saskatchewan somewhere, then somehow ended up back here where he started. Still drunk though, but claims he's getting help. It doesn't seem to be working. I told the manager that if he didn't put a stop to the cook touching me and calling me everything but my name, I was going to file a harassment suit. Every time this cook touched me, I loudly stated, "Don't freaking touch me." It when he called me babe, "I'm not your babe. My name is Harper Fulcati." Everyone in the place knew how I felt. There is no way he thought I was joking or flirting. After a few months, it only had escalated and I had had enough. Turns out one server who shows up on time and leaves her personal life at home is worth more than a good cook who turns up late and causes drama. Finally, justice for the fog. I was called a wuss and that I didn't get it when I complained about the kitchen being freaking vulgar and annoying to the women working. I stopped working service industry years ago because of it. People who've worked for scam call centers. Did you know? And if you didn't, stayed. Why? Worked at one place when I was 19 or so that did public radio pledge renewals. Turned out the boss wasn't actually giving that money to anyone, just kept it. Bunch of suits and uniforms showed up and arrested him. Shut the company down in the middle of the workday. No idea if he was ever convicted or what might have happened to him afterward. Probably jail. That sound like serious fraud. I worked for a call center for about a month that bugged people to donate to charities with very similar names to actual charities. but less than 1% of the pledge would actually go towards a charity. When I found this out, I felt anxious about it and left, basically ghosting on it. No manager or employee of any kind even so much as called once when I missed my next shift. I just stopped showing up and then never heard from anyone again. A few weeks later, I got a call to my landline, that I don't give out, asking if I wanted to come work for the exact same company. In my head I was like, do you guys even remember that I literally did work there and then just stopped showing up? Oh, okay then. Definitely how a legitimate and not shady corporation would act. If you don't know, sometimes people who are hearing impaired have these special phones that can caption any calls that come through. I used to be a captioning agent and was captioning a scam call. Now at that company we have to caption every single call no matter the context. No exceptions. It was some Middle Eastern sounding guy pretending to call the police to frighten this elderly woman into giving him money. The woman was on the verge of crying, but that bastard would not let up. I was not having it. It's totally against regulation, but I told the lady it's a scam and just stopped captioning in the middle of the call until the dude hung up. Frick those scammers. My aunt works for similar place, but they have the right to stop it if they know it to be a known scam. They also stop it if someone threatens the person on the call. Worked for an environmental non-profit as a teen doing calls and going door to door. I didn't really understand the legislation we were getting signatures for, but hey, it's good for the environment. A very very nice hippie lady invited me in and explained that the non-profit I was working for was financed by the oil companies and was trying to backdoor a way to remove any liability for spills in the Gulf. I did some research and, sure enough, that was indeed the case. Told everyone in my office. About half were horrified and the other were like, it's a living aisle left, and so did many others. It was a trash place to work anyway, as you were paid by how much you brought in donations. For a while in Florida, go figure, I was selling Back to the 50s concert tickets. This was to raise money for a police union. But we were told to start off every conversation with, you know, the Just Say No to Drugs program in schools for the kids. Total scam. The concert was all of these has been acts and barely anybody showed. Only lasted a couple of months. I almost worked for a scam that was a water filtration company posing as a non-profit trying to get water to developing countries. I quit during orientation when I was told I needed to pay $400 for a starter kit. I didn't think MLMs could get any worse, but here we are. It wasn't a scam. But I needed a job in college, so I went to the job fair. First booth I approached was the alumni center, connected with the hiring manager, and got the job on the spot. Come to find out, we had to cold call alumni and ask for a gift to the university. The cherry on top was that I was assigned a list of numbers of alumni who had graduated in the 60s and 70s. Few calls ended with widows upset or crying I was asking for their deceased spouse. I lasted 2 weeks and no called, no showed. Not my proudest moment, but needed out. I was 16 and back in the day, circa 2003, Montreal was a huge haven for telemarketing scam operations, particularly those targeting the US. So being young and naive, I started phoning up places that had help wanted ads and the local newspaper. One called me back and told me to come in for an interview. It was a tiny little operation. For those of you from Montreal, right behind the famous Orange Julep, with maybe about 10 people working there. The interview was quick and I got hired on the spot. They explained to me that Visa and MasterCard had an issuing department that they contracted out to smaller centers and we had to help process approved applications to get people their actual cards. I believed it. So I worked there for about 2 weeks. Calling people and telling them that they got approved for a credit card application that they submitted a while back. It could have been up to 6 months ago. I still remember the script, and that we needed to get their information to update their file and rerun the credit check to issue their credit card. It turns out that they were selling them a credit repair kit, but that would only happen during the verification phone call. When the client agreed to everything, the supervisor would come on the line. Dial out to a separate number to make a verification recording with the person on the line, and quickly rush through the information and blurb out the credit repair kit portion at the last second. Funny enough, the times the client objected or hesitated, they'd just hang up and tell me to go to the next person. 2 weeks passed by and then I was due for my first paycheck, on Monday. So I walk in all happy knowing that I must have made a super duper commission. Huh, that's weird. The doors are locked. Hey, they're not answering the phone either. What the? The office is empty and everything is gone. Then another one of my colleagues showed up and sighed. Then he mentioned to me, you didn't think they were really issuing credit cards, did you? So I headed back home all sad. I would spend the rest of that summer working at the grocery store. What the? The office is empty and everything is gone. Wow, that is beyond shady, and I feel sorry for you the most since you did not walk out the first day and stuck through the 2 weeks. Worked a call center in college, lasted all of 2 hours. We were collecting for some state trooper support fund or something, and there was a manager circulating on the floor with his own manager's headset where he could come plug in and listen in on your calls. Dude was a tool. Total Colin Farrell's character from Horrible Bosses type, you know that guy's. Dark purple dress shirt with skinny black tie. Chain wallet. Bad goatee. Starting to lose his hair at 25. Drives a Sentra with an expensive stereo in it and smells like clove cigarettes. That guy. Cut into a call where this elderly lady went from, sorry, I can't contribute anything this year to because I'm having surgery and blah blah. And Todd or Chad or whatever his name was is all bro. You just need to cut people like that off and get to the next call. Frick him. I just realized that was not what I wanted to spend my time doing. Comma dark purple dress shirt with skinny black tie. Chain wallet. Bad goatee. Starting to lose his hair at 25. Drives a Sentra with an expensive stereo in it and smells like clove cigarettes. Lose the chain wallet and car and I'd think you might be describing me at 25. Got a job at a telemarketing place once. First day was told if you are okay scamming people you can make a lot of money. After the intro class we were split into pairs and were told to listen in to the experienced workers. Essentially how it worked was you call into a real company and the scammers would get phone numbers close to the reputable companies. So as you call in and are on hold, you think you are waiting to speak with them. A message would come on. With some kind of scam deal, a free trip, $1 subscription for 12 months that costs you hundreds later on. Things like that. The very first call, this confused senior, who thought she was waiting to speak with her bank. So she willingly gave out things like her credit card number ect. By the time she clued in and realized it was a scam and asked us not to process the information, the rep hung up on her and was actually laughing. Needless to say, I hopped on a bus home after that to go back to the want ads. Comma first day was told if you are okay scamming people you can make a lot of money. I have this horrible image in my mind that they killed the people who walked out when that was stated. Y'all announcing that y'all a criminal organization at that point to all your new hires, WTF. I worked for one company, which acted as two, called Aid Nest and thereafter USDR. While pretending to be two companies. Can I do this? Or do I have to edit the names out? The companies don't exist anymore. Anyway, I found out a couple of months into the job that although it wasn't exactly a scam per se, we were selling a service that people didn't need and could do for themselves. Later though, everything turned into a scam when the following happened. The owner's old business partner sued his balls off, and managed to get all of his accounts frozen. Including of course the ones where all of the client's money went, and where all of our salaries came from. A couple of weeks later, we weren't even allowed into the building anymore. Almost 200 call center agents left on the street jobless. Oh, and during those couple of weeks we didn't get paid but were all forced to come in and try to make new sales to effectively pay our own salaries while things picked back up. They never did. They still owe me about 2.5k USD. We went to the Ministry of Labor. We made quite a fuss and it even made the news, without identifying the company itself. The legal representatives fled the country, and well, I guess we'll all just have to be P forever. It broke my heart every time I continue to receive email notifications which I can't turn off from clients who are still looking for responses and for help with their debt. And I can't even log into the system, which was paid for by the company, because it's not being funded but somehow still receives incoming messages. Don't know how that works. So I guess, what I mean is, if you worked with Aid Nest and haven't been getting answers, that's why. So not only the clients got scammed, but the employees did too. I'm spending way too much time on this comment that probably only a couple of people will read, but I think it's my one chance to help at least one or two people realize that although they didn't start out being scammed, they definitely were eventually because of the piece of crap owner, s. Oh my god. I'd say they know, yes. Next time you get one of those scam calls about your car's warranty, go ahead and push the button to be connected to a representative. Ask them so you know you're working for a scam company that is making unsolicited robocalls, right? Best you ever get is a sigh as they continue to read the script, if they don't just outright hang up on you. One time when I said that I haven't been in a car accident, the person's script told them to say I'm sorry, so they did. And I responded with, so you've called me to tell me you're sorry that I haven't been in a crash. And for whatever reason, they lost it laughing for a solid minute or two. When I was about 19, I worked for a call center for 3 days. They were scamming everyone including the employees. First, shifts were only 3 hours long and you would be scheduled for two of those back to back. That is, 9:12 and 12:33:30. This is because if you are scheduled for longer than that you are 1. Legally entitled to break time too. If you are scheduled for longer than 3 hours and get cut, you have to be paid a minimum of 3 hours. The company would regularly cut you if you weren't bringing in enough money. You were then expected to return for your next shift. I'm sure they screwed people's paychecks somehow, but I walked out on day 3 and abandoned my paycheck. I walked out because that was the day I learned where the money went. See, we weren't selling crap. We were raising money for breast cancer research. The key piece that led me to quit was when I learned that 0.1% of all donations went towards the actual research. The remaining 99.9%? Well, it was lining pockets and funding other centers to scam people. I now only donate directly to a source and even then only after vetting them. I feel like a butthole, but I always say no when asked to donate to things in the checkout line or on street corners. I have no idea what percentage of my money is going to actually reach the charity, or if what they do with the money is something I support. Had an interview for me. Went in. Felt dodgy. Went through into the guy's office. He's chatting away about the business fixing roofs and selling certain types, but you'll only answer incoming calls. As soon as he said that, I knew he was full of crap. The callers closest to the office I watched do callouts and hi, I'm calling from Blascript. I deliberately fluffed the interview from then on and left as fast as I could. Wait, I'm confused. Why did the incoming calls spook you? I had a friend who worked at a scam call center and he didn't realize it until about 2 weeks after I told him that's what it was. When he first described the job to me, selling encyclopedias, educational books by cold calling. In 2010, I told him it sounds like a scam. Not that he's scamming anyone, but the business owners were. He insisted the owners couldn't be scammers because they're average white Americans. This scam call center was in a major US city. My friend was an American who had never left the USA. I had to pick him up from this job once. It was at some random office park. The owner and his wife were at the front desk, dressed like they were on a tropical vacation. We're nowhere near anywhere tropical. Heavily tanned, just looked very out of place and kind of sleazy. I got to see the work area, which was a fold-up round table with a bunch of computers around it. The whole place looked like it could be packed up in a very short time and looked very sloppy. After he got in the car, I told him the place looks extremely shady, to please quit before it gets raided or something, because while I can't be sure, the owners are probably doing something illegal. He finally quit about a week later. I never figured out what happened to the business, but who the heck was buying books from a random phone call, even back in 2010? That reminds me of some scam back in college, where someone called to offer me free magazines. Wasted a bunch of time setting it up to be told at the end it was either $10 a week or $10 a month for the subscription. I can't recall, it was years ago. Told them I was not interested anymore, and it was cheaper to subscribe to the magazines individually. I got hired to work in a loans office on the phone, incoming calls. Basically they come across like a broker, telling people they qualified for certain loans and we would hook them up. We would then send a text with identical links to apply for loans. Pretty much every text had the same links. We charged them for an on-service. They weren't approved for anything. I hated the idea of working there. I thought I'd just get through the training and consider my options. I was hired by an agency. Not the only time I was screwed over by an agency, who assured me that I'd easily make above the lower range of starting wages because I had call center experience. I'd also get to pick my shifts, etc. All lies. Shocker. A place that scams customers also scams employees. S. They refused to even show me a contract until I had worked for 2 days. I lasted 3 days, and probably wouldn't have stayed so long but me husband's cousin worked there and thought the place was ace. I sent a scathing resignation email to the agent and the employer. Get it in writing and don't start a minute sooner. I worked for a company that sold coupon books for $20 a pop. They were signing up for a subscription that would charge them $30 per month after the first month, if they didn't cancel. I always emphasize the cancellation part, but know that I duped lots of people out of money. I made good money for a college student, $14 an hour, plus commission, and I was one of the top sellers on my shift, so got quite a bit extra. People would call in, so I didn't do cold calls, which made me feel a little better. Between calls, I read comics. I put in my 2 weeks so I could focus on school, but when I went to work the next day, they were shut down. Everyone was crying in the parking lot, except me. We were all getting 2 weeks severance. My sister got scammed recently by fake cops. She kept asking to talk to a higher up and their higher up etc etc. They always had someone for her to talk to. I want to know how many people are on the average scam like that. Do they write a script? How do the logistics work like that? Why did my sister make such a dumb mistake lol? Comma, how many people are on the average scam like that? 4 accomplished voice actors. 2 are also pretty good at accents. After I started at one selling credit cards to old people on social security disability, I realized what I was being told to do and I walked out. That place was absolutely awful, and I legitimately felt bad for anyone I successfully duped into signing up with a one-time lifetime member card activation fee of $199.99. I constantly call the crass scammers from India to waste their time. One time I talked to a guy who was new and got his training. He was legit and hated his job. I got his phone number and we talked via WhatsApp. He legit thought it was real until the second day and quickly learned it was a scam. He felt awful doing it and quit not long after but was afraid he'd get killed because it's all organized crime there. They apparently bribe cops to look the other way. I worked in a call center during my senior year of high school along with a few other guys from our DECA class. We had to get a job and somehow this one attracted a few of us. Basically we would cold call and tell people you get a $100 Shell gift card and all you have to do is sign up for this service at $29.95 mo and you can cancel anytime. We were selling free gas. Come to find out the service we were selling was not something you could cancel right away and it required a 60-day notice. The gas card wouldn't be sent out for 90-120 days and it wouldn't be sent out at all if you cancelled before then. So basically you'd have to give 60 days cancellation notice after you received your card. 120 days equals 4 months. 29.95x4 equals $119.80. And then 60 days cancellation equals 2 more months. They made about $180 for nothing and spent $100 on a gas card once they got their money. Frick them. I made $1,000 and that week as a 17-year-old so I was stoked. Then I found out what was happening and we all just spent the day saying was up to people we were connected with on the phone and never went back. Can't talk about any in the US, but my wife regularly gets calls on her business line, forwarded to our house since she works from there, from Indian call centers pretending to be Microsoft. She likes to let them on and just when they think they're going to get access to her PC, she turns on them and tries to make them feel like crap. Do you know that you're preying on old people? How would you feel if someone did this to your mother or grandmother and then the do you have any spiritual beliefs? Do you know you're probably going to come back as a cockroach in the next life? So I work in a third-party call center for US health and my god if they aren't a scam then I don't know what is. I hate this job with a passion and fully plan on quitting once I can land another job. Last time I lost a job, I went 6 months and probably 200 applications later before landing this crap hole of a gig. Don't particularly want to do that again. If anyone is wondering why I think one of the biggest health insurance companies is a scam, They make every applicant go through a 20-30 minute long health history questionnaire that's worded in a way to specifically confuse people. Depending on your past health history, you can be flat out denied. Ever had any kind of DUI or DWI or any run-in with the law, even if it was 15 plus years ago? Denied. Any kind of cancer? Denied. Smoking tobacco use? Denied. Seen a chiropractor regularly, even only for general wellness cause it feels good? Denied. As far as I can tell, they specifically look for healthy people so they can charge them hundreds of dollars every month knowing they won't have to pay out. There are a few people who have one of the above who managed to slip through, but that is because one of the verifiers screwed up and input the wrong information. Heck, for the cancer one, all a verifier has to do is place onk at the end of the doctor's name and you will be denied, even if you said no to having cancer. So yeah, I hate this job with a passion and hope to leave soon. A properly qualified major medical health insurance approved by the ACA, by law, cannot discriminate for pre-existing conditions, with exception to adjusting prices based on age and smoker status, but still no outright denials. These would likely then be temporary health policies, which by and large are indeed scams. Retail workers of Reddit, what is the most desperate scam a customer has tried to pull on you? I was working at a place that has soft serve as a part of the menu. I was working one day and a lady came up to the counter and said something along the lines of, "Hey, I'm really sorry, my daughter dropped her ice cream and she's really sad about it. Do you think you could give me another?" I was about to then realize an important fact. The ice cream was broken that day and we weren't selling any. I looked back at her and told her that it must not be from us because of the machine. She turned bright red and mumbled, "Oh, then I guess it must be from Dairy Queen or something," and left quickly. Nice try, lady. We were at a soft serve place, not a chain, and my son actually did drop his ice cream right after he got it. I was fully prepared to purchase a new one, but they gave us another for free. That's the kind of behavior these scammers take advantage of, and it is a real payoff. This is why we can't all be nice to each other. I worked at a Jewel many years ago. Opening shift as a cashier, a man comes through with 2 24 packs of Pepsi. It's opening shift, so at that time we count our registers and confirm they've got the correct opening cash. We didn't carry too much cash, and we all know how much is in the drawer to start. He ends up paying with a $100 bill for these sodas. I counted back his change with mostly 20s. All the 20s I had just counted. There was no more 20s I could have given him. And I don't know how he did this, but he shuffled them in his hand and showed me that I supposedly shortchanged him. Now, I knew immediately that he was a piece of crap. My store wasn't crappy, so I told him that I would call a manager over and have them double check the register. The manager came, counted down the register and explained that the drawer was balanced, which means I didn't shortchange anybody. But if for whatever reason the drawer turned up $20 over at night, we could give him a call. The manager tries to take his info down and he asks for his name, and the guy thinks about it and says, "Steve Bush." "Frick you, Steve Bush. You're a sack of lying crap who tries to scam 16-year-olds out of $20. I'm well aware that money isn't my money, but I took that as a personal offense. When I left that day, I called my now husband, mad as heck. I felt angry because he must have assumed I looked like an idiot that would hand him extra money, or something of that nature. Also, he can't actually scam Jewel without scamming me first. Just because it isn't my money didn't mean he didn't try to scam me out of $20. We are responsible for how much money we lose. I didn't realize how common this was. People are crap. Ha. Huh. This is an extremely common scam. I would be shocked if any retail worker didn't have it happen to them at least once. 1. This projector is going to be used at our church. Can we get a discount? 2. This flat screen TV is going to be used at our church. Can you waive the taxes? 3. This for church. Discount? Worked at Arby's as a teenager. This was around 1990. A guy comes in, orders a sandwich and fries, and wants to pay with a check. This being the olden days, people paid with check all the time. But this guy tries to tell me it's easier for the bank if he makes it out to himself instead of to Arby's because, well, he fired off some convoluted, off-the-cuff bulls designed to gish-gallop me into buying the story. I was young and naive, but not that naive. He got mad when I denied him, called me stupid. I asked if he'd like to talk to the manager and he agreed. 3 minutes later my manager is giving the guy stink eye and the dude leaves with no sandwich. Nice try, butthole. I work at a movie theater. We have a $5 discount day. A customer comes over and starts telling me how she was there the prior day and that we had given them the wrong soda and her diabetic husband had drank it and suddenly had to go to the hospital to get medication to cure him. Several things wrong with that story. 1. That's not how diabetes works. You don't die from one sip of soda. And generally if you did, you'd have insulin to take. 2. The employee she had complained to in order to call me over had been the only concessionist the prior day and somehow she failed to identify him when I asked her who it was. I asked her for a ticket stubs or proof of purchase, and she came up with nothing. I went to the attendants for the prior day and pulled the report for the movie they claimed to have saw. To my delight, the showtime they claimed to have seen had zero tickets sold to it. I printed the report and went back to meet them. Yay. Sorry, looks like there were zero tickets sold to that showtime. And I showed her the report. She then tried to say we sold her tickets to the wrong movie. I told her that was impossible because then she would have been in the wrong auditorium. She had no response to that. Then she spluttered that she guessed she would just go buy tickets and I said yay, I guess so. She left. Telling me she had a voucher for 50% off in her emails. But she didn't have a copy with her. I was like, no hun. Nice try. When I worked on a checkout, a woman pulled a barcode label from a container of $4 tinned fruit and stuck it over the barcode of a $25 container of medjooled dates. She pretended that she didn't do it. Another time a man carried a $30 bag of dog food the customer service counter without paying for it and asked for a refund. My manager gave it to him even though we both knew he had stole it while we watched him. Oh, and another time a group of people were using fake credit cards to steal. Not sure exactly how it worked, but they ended up typing in a different card number into the VFPurse terminal while another dude tried to distract you. These guys were super friendly and chatty and probably thought I was young and dumb, but I caught them trying to take off with about $500 worth of groceries. They were all like, just let us go and get some cash out. We'll be back soon to pay. They never returned and my manager gave me a box of chocolates for picking up on it. Proudest moment of my retail career. Former worker, name dropping the owner's name while saying everything was wrong and they were going to call him personally and were doing this super doucher buggy exaggerated phone button push thing. Surprise, surprise, they didn't know him. Passed it off as, well, he isn't answering with that voice that comes from a nose a mile high. I work at an Italian deli specialty market. It's family owned and has a super tight knit cast of employees. It's also in a rougher part of town. One day, a presumably homeless woman came into the store. No big deal. We're by the shelter and a lot of the homeless folks are friendly and just getting something nice to eat. However, this lady was clearly out of her mind. Whether it was drugs or mental illness wasn't clear. Honestly, probably both. She was in the store for an hour just harassing employees and customers. Eventually, the owner, the Italian man after which the store is named, had to intervene. He firmly asked the lady to leave, but she had a surprising response. Oh, it's okay. I work here. Imagine the surprise on the owner's face. He certainly didn't remember hiring her. Dumbfounded. He told her that was impossible, since he's in charge of the hiring. To which she responded, oh, are you hiring? Honestly, I've got to respect a good gambit. Unfortunately for her, it didn't seem to pan out. I don't have any new co-workers yet. I had a customer try to pay with a check using an ID that was very obviously made of paper. When I wouldn't accept it, she tried to get her boyfriend to fight me. He laughed and awkwardly walked out of the store, leaving her there, crying now. From the embarrassment of failure, I guess. I understand that some states issue paper temporary licenses. Mine does too. This was clearly not that. Good on the dude for making the right judgment call. Worked at Aldi, which is a return policy where you get your money back and get to pick an item of equal or lesser value. One customer routinely returned a gallon of milk with just a quarter remaining, claiming it was rancid. He'd then get a new gallon and his money back. This went on almost daily for 2 weeks until the DM finally put his foot down. Aldi will do anything to please the customer. It's insane. I'm a customer service manager at my store, and have been for 2 years. So I'm not exactly wet behind the ears. Every once in a while, I get a call from someone claiming to be NCR, the company who repairs our registers. They always start the same: "We've been getting an error message from your store that your money services registers are out of sync." Usually I just say "nice try" and hang up. However, one night the store was dead. I was ahead on my closing stuff. I got the call. I pretended to be dumb and played along, telling him I was doing what he said. "Stupid stuff that doesn't actually do anything. Reset the pin pad, reboot the register, type in a code that prints a slip." So after about 10 minutes, I finally break the news to him that I knew it was a scam. He goes off yelling, "I told your butt we're updating the freaking registers, you tucking dumbass." Not traditional retail, but had a client where she did not receive two packages from me and was refusing to pay the invoice for the second package from more than 6 months prior. I knew she was lying, but she was extremely rude and insistent. I was able to go back on all records and was able to find both a photo of the first package on her front doorstep. Super lucky, as it's not our normal delivery procedure to have photographed evidence, and a signature of receipt for the second one with her name very clearly signed, dated 4 days later. I emailed the evidence and never heard back from her again. Not even an apology email or phone call, which just confirms she knew she was lying. Lately I always get a photo of the Amazon package where the mailman left it. It's actually quite interesting. They cut off a tag off an expensive jacket. I saw them do this, walked up to me and tried to return it. Security showed them the doors. This probably doesn't really count as a scam, but had a teenage boy come into the store and say he had no money but needed condoms desperately for tonight or he wouldn't lose his virginity. I really felt for the dude, so I ended up buying him some myself. I work at a clothing store, and about a year ago I had a very drunk 50 plus year old lady come through my line. After ringing up her $100 plus worth of clothes, she then began to hit on me and insinuate that she could work for the free clothes, if you get what I mean. That was the quickest nope I have ever said in my life. Would not recommend, lol. Lure her to the bathroom, tell her to wait and come back with mop, buckets and gloves. Used to work customer service at a hardware store. You get so jaded by junkies trying to return stolen items, I just started handing out refunds based on how good the stories were. "Your dad with dementia bought circuit breakers every single day and recently died? Refund." "You don't need these commercial sized copper elbows because you bought too many for your residential plumbing project? Nah." The dementia thing is sadly realistic. My uncle recently died of Lewy body dementia, and he kept on buying tools and fishing gear. It made him happy. My auntie would collect them once they got home and put them away to return later, but you couldn't stop him because he would get so angry if he was told he couldn't. Had a guy try to return two Sega CD games for cash. Problem was they were wrapped in saran wrap, and then had the gall to exchange them for properly wrapped games so he could go across the street to Walmart and return them for cash there. Him and his buddy must have really needed beer and weed money. Also have seen people try on new shoes, put the old ones in the box, and walk out with the new ones. Had an old man act like he was pulling a gun out of his waist just to get away from loss prevention. And one of my favorites, had the two women grab a bag from luggage and put all of the rolls of film in the bag, then try to ditch the bag because we were following them. I worked for my mom-in-law at a home decor store. I had an older woman come in, and when I rang her up she said she got a discount because she was the owner's mom. My immediate reaction was to yell, "Grandma," and throw my arms out like I wanted a hug. She left very quickly. BTW, it was not my grandma-in-law. Lmao, I would have loved to have seen that. When I worked at the service desk of a local grocery store, we had this lady who was super skinny and wore sunglasses and long sleeves all the time. One day she came in with a friend and tried to return beauty items. We didn't have a beauty makeup section, and claimed she had no receipt due to short-term memory loss. It was so hard not to laugh in her face. She had attempted to return things this way numerous times. We all knew what she was doing. Maybe she couldn't remember that she had tried that before. Customer shows me a coupon on his phone. Several problems with this. It's against corporate policy to scan coupons off the phone. There's a sheet of paper taped to the counter with all of the rules and it's like the sixth one on it. When my kowtowing ass munch of a manager scanned the stupid freaking thing anyways, the system rejected the coupon, saying that the coupon wasn't issued to him. The offer that the coupon was for was different than the offer shown on his phone. There was an Instagram stamp on the coupon on his phone. Also, customer tries to return some makeup without a receipt. I look it over and tell her I can't return it. She tries to say that we have to since we sell it here and whatnot. I tell her I can't return it because it has a security label from the grocery store that's 5 miles down the road. She books it out and leaves said makeup behind. I had someone try to return 2 bottles of laundry detergent. She dropped them off at the counter and said she didn't like that brand. She walks off to do her shopping. I wonder how it smells, so I open the detergent and smell it. It's water. Both of these jugs are filled with warm water. During the exchange, she tries to claim they were like that when she bought them. I explain I can't return them and she will have to talk to the day manager. Boss lady who has final say. A friend of mine bought a giant bottle of laundry detergent that turned out to be water. He was so perplexed when he got it home and tried to wash his clothes. Someone must have bought it, filled it with water and returned it, and obviously it wasn't checked. Luckily he was able to exchange it at the store with no questions asked, but a lot of laughs all around. I work at a convenience store, and we sell phone chargers for exorbitant prices because they prey on the desperate who need a charger right now. People steal these chargers all the time and try to bring them back for a refund. We don't take them back without a receipt with our store address on it anymore because this is such a common occurrence. I also had a guy steal a fidget spinner. I watched him do it from the aisle and try to bring it back for the whole refund of $6. Customer came in for her 1-hour facial appointment to try our skincare brand in a department store. It was $75. Or you could purchase products to that value or above. She came out from her facial, pampered, requested the whole range, then exclaimed she had left her credit card in her bag, which she had left in the car. She quickly said, "I'll be back in 5, and never returned. We cottoned on pretty quickly, but she had disappeared, and the phone number she had given us was fake. I worked at a place that sold timber, roofing, iron, etc. One Sat morning, this guy comes in and wants a couple of bags of cement, so I ring up the sale and then go to load up the order. He tells me not to worry and that he will do it, so I explain that it is my job to do it. Then when I reached for the first one, he stands between me and the bag. So again I insist that I have to load the concrete, it isn't an option. At this point he gets quite aggressive with yelling and arm waving, etc. So I go inside to find the boss. And just as we come back out, he reaches down, goes to pick up the bag, and throws his back out. He is writhing around on the floor for a while, then demands an ambulance, and tells my boss that I refuse to help him load the bags and now he is going to sue us for millions. What he didn't know is that a lot of people tried to steal the cement, so there were 2 security cameras pointing right at him the whole time, recording everything he said and did, including a long discussion with his wife about how we would pay him a stack of cash to keep this out of court and so on. The company didn't say a word about the tapes until just before we had to be in court, to make sure that he spent as much money on his lawyer as possible. I once had a dude try to score a free iPhone. He came into the department I worked in and started describing this vague iPhone to us, saying he'd lost it in here earlier. No other details were given, like phone case or specific color, just an iPhone. Further questions were asked about where he thinks he might have left it in here, and he just went quiet and said, "It's fine. Actually, maybe somebody else has it," and left. Our opinion is he knew that sometimes stores will keep people's phones that they find until the owners come back and then they hand over the phone. He wanted to score a free iPhone. My son actually lost his phone in an arcade restaurant type place, and the cashier had it in her drawer in lost and found. She wouldn't give us the phone until he told her what was on the lock screen to verify it was his. I thought that was a pretty good thing to do. Had a guy come to the bowling alley I worked at wanting to play in our arcade. You have to put money on a card to play the games, cause we have card swipers on all our games and tickets go straight to the card. He walks into the redemption store I'm in and goes, Hey man, I just put $20 in the teller and it took my money and is saying I didn't put anything in. Can you give me a card with $20 on it? Well, that's weird. Let's check it out. I grab a manager and walk over to the teller where the manager proceeds to open it up and take out the cash box, and will you look there? Not a single bill. Hum, weird. Do these other tellers work? Yeah, bud. All the tellers work just fine. I worked at Best Buy in the late 90s when I was an HS, and a guy set off the alarm when he was leaving, and it turned out he had like 8 CDs in his pockets which he claimed that he had bought at the mall across the street before he came to Best Buy, and it must have been his house arrest anklet that had set off the alarm. Had a young guy trying to buy alcohol once try to use his girlfriend's ultrasound as it. Tried to tell him that you don't have to be over 18 to get pregnant. In the end, I just pointed at the poster that showed the approved forms of it we could accept and told him that ultrasounds weren't on it. So many people seem to forget their license at home. Well, go get it, buddy. You won't get a beer until I see it. Customer returned a fake ring for $100. They had a real receipt that physically described the ring they brought in. I didn't recognize it, even checked for it, but ultimately accepted the return because it seemed legit. What they did was buy a real ring, or obtain a real receipt some other way, then buy a fake $5 ring that matched the description on the real receipt. Return fake ring. Get cash. Actually pretty smart. I was working at Buckle for a while in college. They offer 10% military discount with PhotoID. Lady comes to my register on Black Friday with an alleged photocopy of her husband's DD-214. I kindly told her that would not be accepted and she was not eligible for a discount unless she could produce dependent ID on an official card. She was P. I gave zero fricks. Guess who paid full price? If her husband is in the military, they issue spousal cards in order to access things like the base operated shops. I had one as a dependent and my mother still has hers, though my father is retired. If she was really married to a military member, she would have her own card. I've been in and out of retail for 10 years, and one time at a part-time gig that I had. I have a full-time job, too. This couple, a man and a woman, came in, looking sketchy as all heck. Definitely had a drug problem. They were scanning each and every register looking for gift cards, particularly those ones where they were prepaid like Visa or MasterCard. I knew their game. I've dealt with this before. The woman came to my register. Originally they wanted to go to self-checkout, but I told them they cannot purchase gift cards there. They can. I just wanted to catch them, lol. The woman comes up to me, purchases $400 worth of gift cards, and when it's time to pay, I ask her for her ID because she wants to use her credit card. The ID she had and who she was were two different people. The woman in the driver's license had no tattoos on her face. This woman had stars below her eye. I told her, this is not you. I will not sell these to you, and I will call the police. She booked it out of there. Unfortunately, the man got away with it, because he had purchased his at another register before the woman came to me. And would you believe, I got in trouble for doing that? Customer asked us to open the packaging for something in front of a manager and a co-worker, is happy with the product and takes that, goes to the cashiers and ask for a discount because the packaging was open. Though cashiers called a manager for their permission and it was the same manager who helped open the product. Not exactly a scam, but 2-ish years ago I had a customer try to use a coupon from 2011. His excuse was that he'd been on the road a lot and didn't get a chance to use it. Tried to argue with me and demanded the manager, who, no surprise, said there was nothing we could do, and he finally backed down. I was in line behind a lady at HomeGoods, and from what I heard, she had taken clearance stickers off items and then stuck them on full price items. She had done this with all 10 plus things in her cart. The cashier called her out so hard. For a couple things she was like, I just put these on the floor myself yesterday, and the lady got all huffy and stormed out. It was pretty funny. A customer called my company and complained that my shirt was untucked just to get free coupons. This woman made such a mess out of nothing, and I almost got a write-up over it. I had a customer call in and complain about me because I explained to her that our coffee shop did not have a short size and the smallest cups we had were called small size. Of course, corporate gave her a $5 gift card or something like that, rewarding bad behavior, imo. If you are new to the channel, you can subscribe. I publish new videos every day. Until then, check another video. Bye for now.